And I should introduce myself. I am a professor of economics and information science, also of information science at Cornell University, and some other places I have appointments too, as you tend to accumulate them like barnacles on a ship if you get old enough. And my interest, I'm a theorist, and I believe, Stephen, tell me if I'm wrong, I believe that I'm the only theorist speaking.
You're the only real theorist.
Yeah, just checking. Now, I was pleased to hear that I think I heard one person say that he or she was interested in theory. That's about right for this group, isn't it? One person? Yeah. I want to spend 1 minute actually talking about why theory is, many of you, of course, are labor economists, right? And labor economics, as we know, is largely an atheoretical field. What is the significance to you guys of theory? And the significance to you guys of theory is that all of us, everybody in this room, is interested in making causal claims. And our leader and chief, Professor Heckman, has written that causation, or causality, I don't remember which word he used, causality is a property of a model, right? I think this is actually a stunning statement, if you think about it, that causation is something that I guess philosophers can argue about whether it actually has any ontological import, whether it's actually something of the world. But causation is really our attempt to structure the world. And of course, we do that through models. Every time you make a causal claim, you are, in fact, making a theoretical assertion. And every time you try to demonstrate a causal claim, of course, you're doing this with reference to a theoretical model. One of the things that I find frustrating about the style of modern economics is that in many empirical papers, the theoretical model is not evident, and it makes it very hard, I think, to evaluate causal claims. Now, I know that the people who've written these papers, at least the papers I like, have theoretical models in their heads, but they often don't actually get written down. And actually, my lecture notes contain a stunning example of this, which I'll talk about when we get there. Of course, another thing to know is that even for particular techniques of econometric techniques, you need to actually make reference to a theoretical model. So for instance, there is no way of deciding whether a particular variable is a decent instrument or not. Well, the claim, let me put it differently, the claim that a variable is a successful instrument is in fact a theoretical claim as well. Right, because you're making claims about causation. You're ruling out certain kinds of causal paths, right? In order to say that such and such is a good instrument. So theory is embedded in a lot of empirical practice in ways that are actually pretty subtle. All right. So enough said about that. Now, what is our model for making causal claims? In economics, we use a model which philosophers today call a perturbation model. We have perturbation theories of causality, and the idea is very simple. We jiggle x, and if it changes y, we can say that that x causes y. Now, it's a little more complicated than that, of course, but that's basically the idea. People who write about this in the philosophical literature and in other places, computer science literature where these things occur, actually, the more thoughtful ones like to refer to Marshall as the source of a lot of thinking about this. The idea of perturbation theories actually goes back to Hume, as some of you probably know. Hume said in writing about causation that to say that X causes Y is to say A, that is B. And it turns out, of course, that A and B are really not terribly well connected and lead to kind of different theories of causation entirely. And B was the perturbation model, but the Marshall gets a lot of credit for developing our methodology of comparative statics. And what do we do with comparative statics? We jiggle things. Right, and we and then we see what happens. Right, and this is what allows us to make causal claims. It's one of those rare instances where economics was actually ahead of the game in kind of dealing with these deep epistemological issues. In any event, I think that I am going to be talking about two things really. I'm going to be talking about how briefly about how economists might think about some kinds of sociological constructs and what kinds of sociological constructs we can import into our thinking. And my thinking is not going to be, it's going to be very, I know there are several sociologists in the room, you guys can take a nap, this is going to be really elementary, all right? But the other thing we're going to do is we're going to spend some time talking about network science. I'm particularly interested in social networks, and so I want to introduce you to the to a little bit of what the subject is about and some of the vocabulary and show off some of the results. Now, what I'm going to do is, in fact, I think different from what most lecturers are going to do. I have seen some of the lectures that you're going to see, both in China and here last year, and in China last year, and right? And so I can tell you that, you know, that many of these lectures are going to take some important issues and they're going to dive into them very deeply. And these will be issues that you have already been introduced to in some of your coursework, and so you're going to have a chance to see people who are really good at thinking about this dig deeply down. What I'm going to do instead is give you this broad spray of a bunch of stuff, references which you can dig into later on. And if you've had a chance, I don't know, are my slides posted, Valerie? They will be.
China?
Pardon?
From China or from Chicago?
From Chicago.
Of last year?
Oh, no, okay, this year's are not yet, right?
This year's, everything will be posted on
right, right. Well, it's also true of my, you know, there's a very long reading list at the back of my slides. And basically what I'm kind of trying to do is to give you some pointers to learn about a lot of stuff yourself. That's my goal here. All right, so let's start talking about social life and economics. And here are two views that many people regard as opposing views about the relationship between social life and economics. And I presume that since we're all social scientists here, that all of you have heard of Carl Polanyi. If not, there's Wikipedia. And I think that Wikipedia probably does this well. But you had a chance to read this thing, so I'm not going to read it to you. Polanyi has this idea that all of our, you know, that essentially many of the choices that confront us, many of the decisions that we make, actually the way in which we govern our social life, our economic life, is deeply embedded in social practice. And many economists have claimed that this is, in fact, an opportunity not to choose. That we're, you know, we're guided by all kinds of social regulatory mechanisms. We don't actually really kind of actually make lots of what we, you know, that rational choice theory does not describe, you know, kind of basic man. Now, Harsanyi went on to, Polanyi, you know, went on to say you know, with the rise of the nation state and the rise of capitalism, and in the 18th and 19th century, we get the emergence of this new thing called market society, and market society requires rational man, and so we have invented rational man, and he goes on in this way. But his basic idea, you know, in trying to describe basic human nature, he says that we're essentially, we're essentially governed by all of these invisible forces that we respond to almost automatically, and a very different kind of way of thinking than the way that all of us in this room have been brought up to believe. Jim Dusenberry, back in 1960, and when he wrote this, he was commenting on a paper that Gary Becker delivered at the NBER. He said that economics is all about how people make choices. Sociology is all about why they don't have any choices to make. Now, that sounds like he's drawing a line in the sand. Right, but that is in fact not entirely true. This actually gets quoted a lot, and people use this kind of this quotation as a way of distinguishing kind of the way that economics economists and sociologists think about things. But Dusenberry was in fact arguing for more of a social perspective on economic practice, because he went on to argue in the very next sentence. In the comment on this paper of Becker's, he said, but there's no one in this room, not even Becker, who considers himself free to choose either two children who go to university or four children who stop their education after high school. Okay, that will sound familiar to some of you. I think that although economics and economists have a reputation for not thinking very much about social structure, we don't, of course, argue about it explicitly and think about it explicitly, but certainly you can find references to sociological literature and people being informed by sociological literature going well back into the 1960s and before. So our fields have been intertwined to some degree for some time. So today's version in economics, where trying to consider a social perspective explicitly is, where does that happen? That happens in a literature that some people refer to, and I really don't like this name, but here it is. And maybe the guilty guy is the guy up there in the back who first did this. Name this, referred to as the social interactions literature. Right? How many of you heard this phrase, social interactions, within an economic context? A few of you have, right? So social interaction models are largely what I'm going to be talking about today. Now, economists who write, I'm going to wait a little while before I define a social interaction model. And essentially, it's going to, at the end of the day, be just a game theoretic model. Where do they appear first? What kinds of things have people deployed these kinds of models to talk about? Well, here is a list. There are many more things I could add to the list. My point is that it's hard to think about an interesting field of social policy within the economic sphere that has not been affected in some way by this literature. Now, how do social interactions work? When we talk about social interactions, the idea is that economic life, that economic choices are embedded in some kind of larger social framework, and that larger social framework has an impact on the choices that we make. So what kinds of mechanisms actually create this impact? There are several. People talk about peer effects and stigma. So several of you are interested in the economics of education, right? And you know that there's a huge literature, right, on peer effects in the classroom, right? Other places. There are stories of role models, social norms, social learning. I put a question mark behind next to social capital because I don't really know what social capital is, and of course, many people seem to argue about what social capital is about. I claim that there are more papers that argue over what the mechanism is that actually analyze it in some way, but it's clearly an important concept, in at least as a way of motivating people to write. And if I have time, I know I won't have time, but if I do have time in the second half of my talk, I'll talk about a couple of social capital models. So what kinds of questions do I want to address? I want to think about today about what are appropriate tools for modeling social interactions. And in particular, what I want to do is I want to focus today on peer effects, simply because it's easier to focus on one thing than to try and hit many, many different things. But some of these things are really hard to actually distinguish from one another. So I will describe for you at some point today a general peer effects model, but it's hard to distinguish that in the economic framework, in the way that we model things. It's hard to distinguish, peer effects from social norms, at least from some kinds of social norms, because how do social norms actually work? How are social norms actually enforced? And one thing I think to keep in mind is that economics has a very parsimonious language for talking about individual decision making. Okay, so we have, you know, when we talk about how do individuals choose, what do we have? We have preferences, okay, and we have constraints. Okay, those preferences may be decomposed in some cases into two parts. We have tastes and we have beliefs. Okay, so if we're thinking about choice under uncertainty, we have preferences which are composed of tastes and beliefs. Think about expected utility as a representative example of this kind of model, although it's clearly not the only example. So we have tastes and beliefs on the one hand, and then we have constraints. And all of these different constructs, all of these different kinds of stories about how peer effects might work, if we want to deploy them in the kinds of models that we now use, we have to map them into this very stripped down framework. So we have to ask, well, what effect is this something that I can say affects a constraint? Is this something that I can say affects a belief? Is this something that I can say affects taste? So it's not, it's pretty clear why if you turn to, say, sociology or social psychology, you'll see all this kind of really detailed discussion about different mechanisms, and they're all really going to get compressed in an economic model into essentially the same thing because our models are so stripped down. Now, the question that that you might ask, well, maybe we need richer models, and I want to argue the answer to that is maybe yes, but also maybe no. And the reason for maybe no, the reason for maybe yes is evident. The reason for maybe no is that what do we want these individual models for? Right? Unless you're a behavioral economist, you're actually interested in large-scale social phenomena, right? Phenomena. And if you are, right, what you want to do is you want to take these little individuals and you want to interact them in some way. And say in a general equilibrium model, we'll get out prices, right? Or in a game theoretic model, we'll get out some kind of aggregate. A measure of social behavior of some kind. And if we want to put these little individuals together into some big social system model, then the individuals can't be too complicated, right? Otherwise we have a model that we can't do very much with, right? Imagine what general equilibrium theory would be like if you had to run a model of the brain of every individual who's actually trading in the market, right? You'd never get the theory off the ground. So there's a reason why our models of individual behavior are so very parsimonious, and it's so that we can actually put them together and pay a great deal of attention to the interactions. And I think that the one of the interesting things about this so-called social interaction literature is that it actually focuses in some detail on how those things might take place, right? So you've all seen, all of you have had macroeconomics, right? And you've looked at kind of macro labor models, right? And everything is uniform random matching, right? Right, and in those models. And of course, the world doesn't work that way, right? And the literature that I'm going to talk about is an attempt to flesh out other ways in, to actually capture some of the ways in which the world might work. All right, so here's my plan for today. I'm going to begin by talking a bit about network, a little bit about network science, and I'm going to then talk about labor markets. A little bit I'm going to talk about some of the work of Mark Granovetter and how economists have reacted to this. I'm going to talk a little bit about peer effects and complementarities, games played on networks. Interesting questions have to do with models of network formation. How do people actually form social networks? I'll talk about one instance of that and give you kind of a brief description of what the rest of that literature looks like. I'll probably skip social capital. I would love to get to social learning and diffusion because those are topics that I think about a great deal, but I probably won't. But that's my goal. Okay. So let's talk. Okay. So let's begin by how do we represent a network? Now comes kind of the theoretical part. How do we represent a network? We represent a network by a graph. Now, one thing to keep in mind is that we're going to reduce, right, when we build a model of a social network, when we build a model of social interaction on a social network of some kind, the representation of the interactions that take place, the representation of the kinds of the constraints on interactions that can take place, we use this graph theoretic thing to do that. It's worth noting that that what we often measure when we go out to measure a social network, right? How many of you are development economists in the room? A few of you, right? So, and you know that there is a literature where people have gone out and looked and in villages and said, well, who talks to whom? Okay. That's an interesting thing to do, and the answers to that question can change a lot depending upon how you ask the question. There's a very interesting paper that was published in Science, about within the last decade, by Duncan Watts and a fellow named Georgi Kosinets, And they had access to hopefully appropriate privatized email data from Columbia University for a semester. Someone here is from Columbia, right? Be careful about what you put in your email. And it's not just the NSA who's looking, it's also Duncan, who's now at Microsoft Research. And what they did was to track who talked with whom, who emailed whom, right? So they didn't know your name, of course. They had some hashed, you know, identifier or something like that. But they had nodes, so to speak. They could track an individual without knowing anything about who that individual was. They could track an individual and see what other, quote, individuals this person emailed in the Columbia University system over the course of a day, over the course of a week, over the course of a month, over the course of the term. And when you apply different windows, okay, so the idea was to apply different windows of looking, and that at this data, who did you talk with over the course of a week? Who did you talk with over the course of a month? And then look at the graphs that result. And not surprisingly, as you change the size of the window, the nature of the graph changes dramatically. Right? And the point of that is simply to say that when we think about social networks, there's actually some ongoing process of social interaction, and the network itself that we measure, the thing that we then use as the basis for our models, right, is in fact just some kind of trace of that. And it may be a good-looking trace, it may be a bad trace, it may be appropriate for what we want to do, it may be inappropriate for what we want to do. This problem is sometimes discussed in economics under the rubric isn't the word, but with the idea that somehow networks are endogenous, right? And this is certainly true, that social relations are changing. Sometimes with respect, you know, because of the things that we want to study, if you become a juvenile delinquent, then you begin to hang out with other juvenile delinquents. Or maybe you became a juvenile delinquent because you already hung out with those people, and we have to untangle that, right? But in fact, this problem of how do we represent this kind of social interaction is, I think, a bit deeper than that, and no doubt over time we'll begin exploring that more. All right, so let's get back to technical stuff. A directed graph is a pair, a set of vertices, vertices or nodes, and then we have a set of edges. And in a directed graph, the edges have pointers that point which way they go. And so these point, you know, it might be, for instance, that I influence you, but you don't influence me, or vice versa, okay? And in a lot of work that we see out there, we just look at undirected graphs, which is essentially a way of saying that the influence goes in both directions, equally so. Often, we will talk about looking at weighted graphs. So it may be that Stephen influences me only a little bit, okay? But Jim Heckman, influences me a great deal, right? So there would be the way that I model these things, and there's a reason for this. There would be an arrow from me to Stephen, but that would have a weight that would be a smaller weight than the Heckman weight, okay? Stephen, if I'm in Madison giving this lecture, the weight's reverse.
Actually, I was concerned to hear about the signs.
And that actually raises an interesting point, because it is very interesting that in almost all of the research that I've seen in economics, we use networks as a way of talking about what are called strategic complementarities. Right? A positive affiliation, right? Stephen being a role model is someone that I want to mimic, right? But on the other hand, of course, one can imagine richer kinds of interaction where we have both negative affinities as well as positive affinities. Stephen and I have been in many department meetings, I'm sure, where if person X vote yes, it means that we will therefore vote no, right? who's X? We'll talk about that later. And I have to say that that poses interesting problems for theories of games played on social networks that we're not going to talk about today. So just getting on with some more terminology very quickly. We talk about the degree And I'm largely going to, well, I guess I'll spend 50-50 talking about directed and undirected networks. But if we have a undirected network, the degree is just the number of edges that connect to that person. So in the graph on the left, the degree of C is 1, the degree of B is 3. Okay. When we have a directed network, we actually talk about in degree, the number of people who point to you, and out degree, the number of people that you point to. Okay. And those, of course, will be different things. A path is in a network is simply an ordered list of nodes. We start at V0, we end at Vn. Nodes, vertices, same thing. We traverse along edges. Okay. A shortest length path is called a geodesic. There might be, if we look at the graph on the right, we see that there are two ways. Well, actually, there are many. There are infinite ways in which you could traverse from C to A. Right? You could go from C to A directly. You could go from C to B to A. You could go from C to B to D to B to A. And of course, you can oscillate back and forth doing that BD thing as often as you want, getting very, very long paths. Right? And the shortest way from C to A is obviously the one-step link. Here what I've done is to talk about a geodesic from C to D, which is CBD, the shortest path, 1-2 links, versus, say, CABD, which is a 3-link path. A subset of vertices is connected if there is a path between every two of them, and a component, that's a term of art, a component of G is a set of vertices which is maximal with respect to this property of connectedness. So here we have a graph consisting of 8 vertices or 8 nodes, and it has 2 components. Okay, the component on the right is a clique because all geodesics have length 1. Within the component, okay? Which is to say that everybody is one step away from everybody else. That's a very dense world, okay? That's not true, of course, in the graph on the left or the component on the left. One way, and this is very useful for econometric purposes, one way of representing a graph is to draw what mathematicians call an adjacency matrix and what sociologists call a sociomatrix. At least some do. And the idea is that we have a matrix whose rows and columns are labeled by the vertices. And I didn't put the labeling in here because I just got exhausted doing, you know, how many of you are TICC users? Any of you? You are, right? You know, it just gets to be a pain trying to figure out where everything goes, right? And you just quit after a while. Okay, so starting on the far left, it's, oh, there's a pointer here. This will be very exciting, okay? It is, oops, that was not the right thing to hit. Okay, maybe we will just punt on the pointer. Okay, we will punt on the pointer. It is A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H, okay? And going down, the rows are A through H, and going across, the rows are A through H. And there is a zero in a, if we look at, for example, AH, that is the AH element of the matrix. That's the first row all the way to the right. There's a zero there because there is no link from A to H, okay? But every place there is a link, we put in a one. All right, and you'll notice that this is a symmetric matrix because this is an undirected graph. If there's a link from A to B, then there's a link from B to A. If this were a directed graph, then this matrix would not be symmetric. Yes? Why are the diagonals all zero? Well, in the one can have graphs with self-links, right? You can have a graph with a loop, okay? But typically for the phenomena that we want to talk about, you would separate out individual effects separately in a model, and so you wouldn't bother, you wouldn't kind of want to record influencing yourself, okay? But one could, right? Another thing, by the way, that one can do is one can have things called multigraphs, where you have multiple links, and these links might represent different things, right? And so this literature gets very complicated very quickly, but all the basic, you know, but basically it's this, okay? Moving on, By the way, notice how you can see the component structure here, that there are these blocks, right? That this is a block diagonal matrix, right? And every block actually corresponds to a component, okay? Okay, and if this, by the way, if we had weights here, of course, instead of ones and zeros, we'd have zeros for no links, but we'd have numbers of different magnitudes for where edges exist, typically positive numbers, except for when Stephen is negative, there would be some negative numbers there as well. Okay, so here we have a typical graph. This, by the way, is a drawing that I stole from my favorite textbook on this material, which is written by David Easley, my colleague at Cornell, and John Kleinberg, my colleague at Cornell, also my co-authors. The book is called Networks, Crowds, and Markets, and it is an essential reference if you're interested in this stuff. So here we have a graph with three components, two of the components, the AB component and the, actually that's not true. One of the components, just the AB component, is in fact a clique. You know, if it has two, it's all it could be. You'll see that, and here's a number of, I've recorded here a number of things that are measures that people talk about when they want to characterize what a network looks like. It's interesting to count the number of components and ask how big is each component. And so you'll see people talking about the size distribution of components. Okay. The min degree of this network is 1. The max degree is 4. H, I think, has 4. The degree distribution is another thing that's measured, right? What fraction of the population is very densely connected at one step to a lot of people? What fraction is not terribly connected? And people make a big deal out of what the tail of that distribution in particular looks like, right? There's a claim that in social networks, these things look like power laws, okay? We also, another thing that gets measured is the diameter of a component. What is the longest geodesic in a component? And I think that I've made a mistake here because I think I've said that the diameter of the third component, the big one, is 3. But I think looking at it, the diameter is actually 4 because I don't think you can get from K to F in less than 4 steps. Well, actually, it's 1, 2, 3. It's 3 edges. It's the number of edges. So it is 3. Okay. These are things that one measures. There are other things that one measures as well, and we'll talk about them. Well, here's a list of some things. The graph diameter, the maximal geodesic length measured by the number of edges. The mean geodesic length, what is the average distance that you have to traverse to get from one person in the network to another? The degree distribution we talked about, component size distribution we talked about. What is the clustering coefficient? The clustering coefficient is interesting because it is claimed that in social networks, that the phenomenon, if you look at this, the second component on the component on the right, the CDE component, we have C connected to D, or C connected to E connected to D, but there's no link between C and D. However, you probably all heard the saying that the friend of my friend is my friend, right? What would that say about the network? That would say that friendship is a transitive relationship. What does it mean to say that friendship is a transitive relationship? Is that all potential triangles are in fact closed. Right? That if you've got the CE and the ED, then you should have the CD as well. Okay? It becomes interesting then to talk about what fraction of all triangles are closed, which is to say have all three edges, rather than is open having only two of the three edges. And we'll be talking more about this later on. A fun sport to do is to go out and find some social networks and measure them, okay? Measure various things. And this was something that was popular to do in the early 2000s. It's occasionally done today. These come from a number of different studies. Film actors, you can guess where that network comes from, right? How many of you have hit the Internet Movie Database? No hands go up, so everybody in the room is lying, right? Okay. I don't believe you can sit there watching a movie and not Google to see what else has that guy been in, right?
Yeah.
Okay. All right. So we have Film Actors Network, company directors. This is often studied and very interesting. Co-authorship networks have often been studied. And here we have three different disciplines, so on and so forth. The email message thing is the Columbia study that I mentioned, and the sexual contact networks have been studied a lot, because if you're interested in, for example, the epidemiology of STDs, you want to know something about that network. And we'll actually talk about that perhaps in just a little bit. So here are some typical measures. Mean degree, typically the degree distributions, as I said, look like power laws in most social networks. And so here, where it's been measured, people talk about what is the exponent of the power law. The source of this list is in a paper that is in the reading list for the class. The reading list is attached to my notes, and it's very, very long. Okay, and there's a paper by Mark Newman that he wrote in 2003. I don't remember where it is that actually contains this. And one of the things that I think that is interesting in social networks, this seems to be a characteristic of those that have been measured, is that the mean geodesic length, namely the distance on average that I have to traverse, that one would have to traverse to get from one randomly chosen person to another, seems to be small relative both to the number of nodes and to the number of edges. If it's small relative to the number of nodes, you'd say, well, gee, that just means that there's lots and lots of links. Everybody's connected to everybody else, right? In what we would call the complete graph, where every possible edge exists, right, then everything is only one step away, right? But what's interesting is that it's also small relative to the number of edges. And that's a statement that says that there's some interesting feature about the topology of these networks, right? That even though the networks might be rather sparse, nonetheless, they're arranged in such a way that traversal is easy. Okay. All right. So now I want to come back, and now I want to do something different. I want to talk a bit about how one might actually study social networks. And so what I very briefly want to do, and I want to take no more than about 5 or 10 minutes to do this, is to talk about two different papers, both having to do with crime, that approach network analysis in a very different way. And I don't really want to talk about crime, although I think it's a very interesting subject, and I've actually written something on that myself. But what I want to do is just hold these up as representative ways, different representative ways of looking at a network. So the first paper that I want to talk about comes from a criminology journal. Again, you guys have had the chance to read this. Okay, what are these guys doing? What do Menace and Harris want to do? They have a data set from Philadelphia. Okay, in fact, I think that at least one, maybe both of them, are at Temple. I'm not sure. And they had this data set on juvenile offenses, and they wanted to talk about the effects of repeat offenders on inducing other people to go into crime. Okay, I'm going to skip all of this. Why don't I just go here? What they did at the end of the day was to build a, by the way, when you see something like this, right, you have a particular way of looking at this, right? I, as a theorist, have a very different way of looking at this. It's like I shut my eyes. So do not ask me about the standard errors and how they clustered them. I don't know. What they did actually was to estimate, a Loget model. And what they were interested in, of course, was looking at the at peer effects. So what they did was they had addresses of where juvenile offenders lived, and then they asked, well, who else lived in the neighborhood, right? Was there clustering of addresses of juvenile offenders? Okay. Now, of course, you would expect some clustering because people in different socioeconomic strata, engage in juvenile offenses at different rates. Okay. And certainly, we see a lot of clustering by socioeconomic characteristics. So we want, you know, we want conditioning on that, right? We're asking, is there still further clustering, right, that comes about, right? And more than you would predict just by the fact that, you know, that high offending people and high offending populations might just tend to live together, okay? We want to look for something beyond that. And so they ran this logistic regression, and the thing to look at is actually model 3, and what you see is that the contagion effects. So what they did was they divided Philadelphia into these rather small areas, and then they looked at the rate of offenses here comes a neologism, by recidivated individuals. You know what recidivism is? It's when you kind of do it again, okay? And these are people who have been, I'm using this neologism to refer to people who have committed multiple offenses. And what is the number of people, the fraction of people in a neighborhood who have committed multiple offenses, and then what is the impact of that on first activity of others? Right, and the idea of this study was to get in a more deep way at the phenomena of recruitment. Are people really recruited into crime? Or, you know, some people say that apparently there is an argument about this in the literature, and I have notes on this that I won't talk about that says that you can't make much of the fact that most juvenile crime is done in groups, because after all, teenagers do everything in groups, right? And so there's nothing really special about that, right? And yet other people want to argue that in fact, that this grouping is in fact a potent force in creating crimes, in fact that there's recruitment that goes on that is done in a kind of a group way, and so people are trying to untangle this mechanism. The point of looking at this is to say that here is a study that actually looks at behavior of individuals, single individuals in a social network. And then the idea is to, and then so at the end of the day, here we have a map. I'm sure everybody from Philadelphia recognizes this, right? This is Philadelphia. You agree. Okay. More or less Philadelphia, right? And blue is where there are, where there is some crime, but the probability are low in the Logit model. Red is where there's significant clusters of high probabilities of criminal activity predicted by the model. This is predicted by the model. The dark gray is where there are clusters where the probability is effectively zero or very, very small. And then everything else I get is probably not residential neighborhoods. That's my guess. But the idea and reason I show this is that what they want to do, the point of the paper is to show that there's this clumping. And the way they do this is by studying individual behavior and then simulating the model. Okay. So the methodology is to move from the micro to the macro. Okay. Now, very often, what we want to do in social networks is we want to talk about what some people refer to as emergent properties. All right. So what do I mean by an emergent property of a social system? Or an emergent property of any kind of system. I could be referring to physical systems as well. And I'm going to state this a little bit technically. I'm going to say that we have equations that describe the behavior of actors in the system. Okay, and of course, those equations exist at a certain scale. So here, we have models of individual choice. Right? What is the probability that a given individual is going to commit a crime given, you know, his or her circumstances, okay? So we have these, and those are the driving equations of this network analysis. But now what we want to do is we want to look at properties that exist at a scale which is different from the defining scale of the, different than the, let me say that again. I want to look at properties that exist at a scale that are different, a scale which is different from the scale of the equations which define the system. So for example, the driving equations of the system are all at the scale of individuals, right? But it's the aggregate properties that we might be interested in. What is the spatial correlation of crime, right? What is the what are the mean crime rates? Things like that. And of course, how can we change these things ultimately by jiggling various parameters that we as policy types might be able to get a handle on? All right. So that's one way of studying them, is to move from the micro to the emergent properties. Another way of studying them is to actually look at the emergent properties themselves and then try to adduce what's going on at the driving equation level. Okay, so here is a well-known paper that appeared in the QJE. The fundamental fact here so this is a paper. How many of you have actually read this paper? This is by Ed Glaser, Bruce Sacerdote, and Jose Scheckman. Anyone come across this? You have? No one else has. Okay. So this is a cute little paper, it is. The idea, what they were focused on is they said that suppose that you know, they were struck by the fact, as many people were struck in the late 1980s and early 1990s, about the high variance of crime rates as you move across cities in the United States. Okay, and that variance seemed to be much bigger than what you could account for, assuming that people were people were independent criminals. Okay, so we all have different circumstances, and the rate at which I might commit a crime is going to depend upon my circumstances, whether I'm poor or rich, so on and so forth. Okay, but the question is you know, am I an independent actor? Right, and if we look at the variation in characteristics of individuals and cities, and then we look at the variation in crime rates, it seems that a model of independent action can't sustain the kind of heterogeneity of variance that we actually observe in the data. And so that's what Ed, Bruce, and Jose wanted to talk about. So their idea was, well, maybe individuals are not, in fact, independent actors. Maybe, in fact, they are coordinated in some way. They're linked together so that if one individual commits a crime, it makes it more likely that someone else is going to commit a crime, ceteris paribus. Okay? All right? They wanted to work out the statistics of that. Okay? And then look at aggregate crime rates to talk about whether this dependence exists or whether it does not. All right. So again, the driving equations, they don't actually have models of individual choice. Well, they do have kind of a model of individual choice. There's an implicit model of individual choice, which runs at the individual level, but they want to look at the aggregate behavior of the system and then ask whether or not this is consistent with a particular property of stuff going on at the individual level, namely dependence among individuals. Okay? All right, is that clear? That's conditioning on all their socioeconomic characteristics. All right, so how might we expect that that to work? Okay, so here is a story that they told. They might have even had a picture like this in the paper, I don't recall. So we're going to imagine that we have a bunch of people living on the line, right? And we're going to imagine that everybody influences the person on their right, okay? So the arrow points to the person who influences you. I'm not kidding, this is actually what's in the paper, okay? They then kind of, you know, ramp it up a little bit by saying, you know, in the appendix, they say, suppose the arrow points both ways. Okay. And then they, you know, they do a more complicated calculation that gives you the same answer. Okay, so they say, so let's imagine that there are three types of individuals. Really, really good people in the world who never commit crimes. There are really, really bad people who would commit crimes no matter what. These are the sociopaths. And then in between, we have a large fraction of people, that's going to be the point of this, a large fraction of people who essentially are influenced by their neighbors. And in particular, in this case, it's going to be influenced by the neighbor on their left. Okay, and so they will imitate, okay, what their neighbor does. So if we look at this picture here, we have the blue, okay, this is a good person. Then we have a couple of type twos, right? And then we have the red, that's a bad person, okay? And now we want to ask, okay, if this is the structure of a population, well, what does criminal activity look like here? Well, here you can see, if this person is blue, then this guy is going to be blue because he's imitating the blue. This person imitates this person, so he becomes blue. Aha, but now the chain of blue stops because we've hit a red, and now that initiates a chain of red that'll keep going until we hit the next type zero, the next blue person. Okay? And that's the model, okay? Sometimes the most insightful models are really, really shallow technically, and this is one of those. Okay, so now you want to ask, what do the statistics of the population look like, and in particular, what do the variance of the population look? Does the variance of the population look like? Essentially, it's not hard to show that if we label, so we're going to assume, by the way, and I didn't say this, and I should have, that the allocation of types is done. Independently across the population, so everybody reaches into an urn and draws with replacement either a red, a blue, or a black ball, okay? And P0 is the probability of a blue ball, and P1 is the probability of a red ball, okay? And so it won't surprise you that if we think about labeling the following way, if we say that 0 is no crime and 1 is a crime, then we ask, well, what is the expected criminality of a given individual? Well, it's going to be P1 over P0 plus P1. That's pretty intuitive. But the interesting thing to notice is to get down to the very end and notice the variance. So the variance, so if this were an IID world, right? The variance would be, so we've got P, the probability that a given individual is going to commit a crime. If all individuals were independent, okay, in other words, if there were no type, if P1, 0 plus P1 summed to 1, there were no type 2s, okay, then the variance would simply be P times 1 minus P, we'd be done, okay? But because of the social interaction effect, okay, because of this imitation effect, the variance is blown up by a number which is, I've told you what it is here, I'm not going to bother to unpack it, 2 minus pi divided by pi, that's a number that's bigger than 1, okay? Pi is p0 plus p1, which is less than 1, so the numerator is a number that's greater than 1, the denominator is a number that's less than 1, and so the point is that the effect of social interaction is to blow up the variance, the effect of this imitation, and furthermore, what is this? This pi is the probability that a given individual has some labeled type, is either criminal or good, okay? So the smaller the fraction of people who are labeled at the outset as either criminal or good, the larger the variance of the crime rate within a given population. So now the idea is to look at each city, right? And to say, well, what's the variance in this city? What's the variance in that city? And then use that to estimate pi. Okay, now they don't really, you know, they're not really estimating pi, but what they really want to say is, look, we carry away from this the idea that variances blow up by some scale factor due to a social interaction effect, and now we want to estimate essentially what the deviation from the IID prediction would be, and think about this as a scale factor, and they do this, and this is actually a copy of the table in the paper. They had... I can tell you something about the, what did I want? Yes, the one of the things that crime data is not as good as it could be, right? The 1985 row comes from FBI cross city data. The New York City row comes from New York City precinct level data. Schenkman lives in New York City, everything else is actually FBI data. So what they wanted to measure, so the scale effect is this thing called F of pi. And the point is, they want to say, look, if F of pi were 1, then individuals would be acting independently, and what we see is that F of pi is in fact much bigger than 1, indicating some kind of social interaction going on. Now, what the nature of that might actually be, of course, is very unclear. This is, after all, at the end of the day, really a reduced form model. What this paper simply did was to say, look, imitation or social structure of this kind causes dependence, and that dependence causes higher variance in crime rates. Now let's scale that in some way. That's effectively what this exercise is. The reason why I put this here, though, is because, again, What they want to conclude is that, look, this is not an IID world, okay? That some kind of social relations are important. Well, social relations are one explanation of why you would see this blow up in variance. And the blow up in variance beyond IID is really well documented here. And what they're doing is arguing from the aggregate now down to the micro. That's the key point here, okay? Rather than trying to estimate the behavioral equations of the model, they derive some aggregate level, some emergent properties of those equations, and then they estimate that, right? So kind of a more indirect approach. All right, so now I want to shift to another topic. I want to talk about properties of graphs, okay? So I don't have my notes really well organized to say at this moment I'm going to be talking about, you know, kind of, you know, mathematical stuff about graphs and then this stuff about economic theory and then at this moment about empirical work. The way that, you know, to have a section I'm going to talk about empirical work would imply that I'm really going to kind of dive in and talk about these papers, and I don't want to do that, okay? I just want to use these papers to illustrate, you know, how you might think about things. And I see this all of a piece, okay? So now what I want to do is I want to talk about some properties that we might observe in large social networks. Now, one thing that I worry about in social network analysis, you know, a very common thing to do is to go out and measure social networks, okay? And there are essentially two ways that this is done. One way that this is done is what you see in the development world, where you can get graduate students like yourselves to go into villages and hand out questionnaires or take someone through a questionnaire and figure out, you know, what the social network within the village looks like. And that's a rather small population, okay? And so for small networks, right, we can essentially measure them, you know, in this way, right? Now, how do we study large social networks, right? Well, what's the equivalent way of asking, going out and asking who's in the network? What you do is, can you all hear me? Because I feel that my voice is kind of slowly dying. Okay. So what you do is you go to a place that has lots and lots of data. You go to Facebook, right? All right. And so the Facebook data set has been studied by the relatively few people who has access to that data, and one of whom is my colleague Kleinberg, and then you can, you know, talk about what those networks look like, or you can go to places like the IMDb, for example, or you can scan bibliographic databases, right, which is where the co-authorship stuff comes from, right? Math Reviews is online, and other places for getting this data. Now, the problem with this is that, you know, so what we know about large networks is largely what we know about online data sets, okay? And a question you might ask is, well, you know, what properties do the online data sets share, you know, with the network of Philadelphia teenagers, right? And we have no clue. Right. So there is a large literature which sociologists have, you know, I think kind of dominated, which is to say, how do you infer properties of a network just by sampling parts of it? Okay. Now this is actually, you know, so to understand why this might be hard, think about the simplest network to study, and that's the line. Right? So whenever I want to think about statistics of networks, I begin by thinking about time series, right? Because time series is essentially stuff that happens on a network, and in fact, it's a directed network, so that what happens yesterday influences today, but at least in my world, what happens today doesn't influence. What actually happens today doesn't influence yesterday, right? How is it that, you know, so how do we kind of infer things, right, about stochastic processes by, you know, by basically sampling, you know, from this network? Well, we have to make assumptions, right, that say something about how the network properties, or how the properties that we're observing on this particular straight line network, are reflective of the entire network, which is to say the entire line. And of course, the key assumption is, there are two assumptions that are made a lot. One is stationarity and the other is ergodicity, right? Okay, and so this allows us to say, for example, that I can look at something like 100 periods in a row and look at the mean and then say that this is suggestive of what's going on the network as a whole, right? That if I were to look at the entire intertemporal data set, you know, that this would, you know, that I now can infer something about, say, the mean, right, of this variable, of a given variable. What are similar properties that would allow us to sample some part of a network and then say, well, this is somehow reflective of the network or representative of the network as a whole? That's a really hard question, right? And there's a literature on this, I know a little bit about this literature. Professor Drilloff actually knows a lot about this literature. You know more than I. All right, I know. I've just said that you know very little, but.
I was trying to figure out whether that was a compliment to me or insult to you.
I'm really beating on myself today, but it is also a compliment to you. So in any event, this is, again, for those of you who are interested in these kinds of things about how one actually measures networks themselves, and large networks, right? Not small networks, but large networks. Something to think about. Now, one way of doing this, right? Think about, you know, is to say, let's imagine that the network, if you think that every network is its own unique thing, right? There's really nothing to say, right? I mean, if we think one way of thinking about this question is to imagine that there's some generative process of network formation that we're not necessarily going to model. We may model it, right? And there's a literature on that, right? This is the, you know, for example, if you think about Jackson and Walensky and Gale and Chapley and stability, right? That would be one kind of model. We also have purely statistical models, random graph models, which is what I'm going to talk about in just a second, right? So if you think that there's some underlying generative model, right, that what one can do is ask, well, for generative models in different classes, what are the general properties of the graphs that they produce? Okay, so I'm now going to talk about one important generative model that has led to a lot of thinking, and it turns out that some of the properties that appear in this model are common in other models, and others are not. But this is maybe a good place to get started in thinking about this. So I'm going to talk about statistical models of network formation. And the first one I'm going to talk about is what's called the Erdős-Rényi random graph, or sometimes called the binomial random graph. Here's the idea that we have a bunch of nodes, and we pick up two nodes, and we flip a coin to decide whether there's going to be an edge between them, okay? And what we're going to do is we're going to generate an undirected graph this way, all right? So for every pair of nodes, there's going to be a link between them with probability p, with probability 1 minus p. There's not going to be a link, okay? So now we're going to get a network. We flip enough coins, and we have our network, okay? So if we have n individuals, we have n choose two possible links. We flip the coin n choose two times. We draw the graph, and we're done. Okay, and now we want to ask, what properties does that graph have? Right. Well, that particular graph may or may not have all kinds of different properties. But what we can ask, of course, is on average, or with probability one, with high probability, with low probability, what do we expect to see in these graphs? Okay. Now, when n is small, there's not going to be very much that you can say at all, right? So the experiment that we perform is to now imagine that we're going to let the number of nodes go to infinity, and we're going to perform this experiment, right, for different n's, and now we're going to ask, what happens as n gets large, okay? All right? And what we're going to do, if we keep the probability of a given link being formed fixed, and we let n get very large. As n gets very large, right, the number of nodes that any one individual has scales linearly with n on average, right? So we're all going to have, like in the limit, we'll all have an infinite number of links. That's not a very interesting mathematical object, right? Or social object, okay? So what we're going to do is the following. We're going to let, as n gets large, we're going to shrink p in such a way that the mean number of links that an individual has, right, remains constant, right? And that should remind you of the Poisson approximation to the binomial, right? Does? Bells ringing? Okay, I know it's summer. The bells ring slower, but okay. All right. So we're gonna have this number z. We're gonna let n get large, and we're gonna shrink p so that the average number of links that an individual has is gonna be p times n minus one. Right, there are n minus one other people out there. For me, we have to flip the coin for every one of these n minus one people. P times n minus one is gonna be the number of links that I'm gonna have on average. Right, and we're going to keep that fixed as we increase n. Okay, so what does the graph look like? So the cool thing about this is what gets everybody excited who likes this technical stuff, is that here's the magical phrase, a phase transition, right, in the structure. So what happens when z is very small, when z is less than one, as we let n get large, what we're going to end up with is a graph that has lots and lots of islands. Okay. And the islands are going to have an exponential size distribution, okay? Somewhere in my notes, I can tell you how the size distribution relates to z. But basically, what's happening is that the average size of a component in this network, you know, when I say islands, that's what I mean. I mean, we have these components that are not connected to each other, right? We have these a whole bunch of components. The number of components grows linearly as the number of nodes grows, right? And the distribution of sizes of the components is an exponential distribution that's related in some way to this number z. Okay, so that's what happens when z is small. Now, what happens when z exceeds one, right? When everybody has on average more than one link, okay, now we get a very different picture as n gets large. So what we're going to do is we're going to have a single component. Imagine it's a single component that gets large, right? It scales linearly with the size n, okay? And so the largest component, In the z less than one case, I think what happens is that the size of the maximal component scales like log n. But now when we go z crosses 1, the size of the largest component scales linearly with n. So we're going to have what is called this giant connected component. And then we're going to have these small components, you know, floating around as well. And the small components all grow, again, log n, consistent with the exponential story, and they have an exponential size distribution, but there's going to be this large component. Now, when z is very, very near 1, the large component is growing linearly with n, but it still contains a very, very small fraction of everybody. Okay, but as z gets larger and larger and larger, a larger fraction of the population gets caught up in the giant connected, what's called the giant connected component. Okay, is that clear? Okay. Here I have a little picture that I found online that shows this. We have a simulation of these Erdős-Reni random graphs on where we have 300 nodes and we change z. And you can see, essentially, if we measure the number of people that are involved in the largest component, I don't really like the way they, because it's not a giant component down here, but if we look at the fraction of people in the population who are in the largest component, okay, you can see that for z less than 1, it's really small, but then as z increases, it takes off, okay? Now, think about this. Why should you care about these kind of arcane mathematical facts, right? Let's think about a risk-sharing network. Let's think about a financial network, okay, where people are connected by risk-sharing contracts, okay? And let's think about what happens when we have a financial event of some time, like a large bank going under, right? Well, that's going to have an impact on the on the banks that they contract with, on the individual, on the agents that they contract with, because this large bank that just went under can't meet their obligations. And that in turn is going to have an impact on the people that these first order banks contract with, right? Because they might not be able to meet their obligations, and so it goes. And so we have a kind of a contagion phenomenon, right? And much was made of this, right, as an explanatory story for the nature of the 2008 collapse, right? So whether or not there is a giant connected component is going to make a big deal. It's going to be a big deal, right? Because if Z is pretty large, say we're up here near 3 or something like this, if you thought this was a Bernoulli random graph, right, then you would say that, some really, a decent fraction of the population is in this connected component, so the potential spread of contagion is very, very large. Maybe we want to have regulations that basically force this parameter Z down here, or maybe just over here or something like that, right? So I've written a paper about this that started out to be about financial markets but ended up being about AIDS, because basically if you want to talk about contagion, it's easier to do this epidemiologically, right, than it is to kind of think about the complexities of banks, bank balance sheets, right? Is it Robert May? Yes, Robert May has actually written papers on contagion in financial markets, which have appeared in soundbite science journals like Science and Nature. And he's written them with Andrew King, who is connected with the Board of Governors, has been on the has some connection to the Board of Governors of the Bank of England. And I'm looking at
Haldane?
Pardon?
Is it Andrew Haldane?
Haldane?
Or Mervyn King?
It's not Mervyn King. It's a younger generation, right. But I think it's King, but I'm not sure. But if you Google for Robert May and finance, it's an odd combination of words, right? May is a very distinguished biologist, right? And you'll come up with some papers in Nature, and they have pretty pictures, as everything in Nature does. And they did agent-based simulations of financial collapse on networks. Now, the reason I talk about this giant connected component is because this is a feature of many random graph models, okay? That there will be some kind of connectivity threshold in the parameters that describe the model, such that if you cross it, you begin to get a large component. Okay, and the phenomena that when you have a giant component that it's unique, this is very robust, and there are theorems in the math literature about this. And there's a question in the back of the room. I'm going to actually walk up so I can really hear you.
Sorry.
Part of having a cold is that I can't hear anything.
All right, going back to the bank contagion example, just mm-hmm. talking about, how can we possibly subtly identify the connections between individual players, agents in the model, or the connections that for all of them to a common factor, like the price in the market?
All right, I want to rephrase your question. Tell me if I've got it the right way. How can I identify a contagion effect versus a shock that affects everybody
exactly.
in the market? Okay. And that's a very good question. And I'm saying mindless things like that so that I can think about an answer. I think I think oftentimes, right, we know, if we know something about the nature of the collapse, right, so then typically we actually know something about what the shock is, right? And, if you know something about what the shock is, if your shock is just a Ned Prescott shock, then you're not going to know anything. It could be anything, right? Or it's whatever your model tells you it's going to be, and your model will give you the answer to that question. You will have assumed the answer to that question when you wrote down your model. But actually, when we look at the historical events that, for any given financial crisis, we can actually talk, we can make reasonable claims about, was there a key bank that failed that somehow caused stuff to happen, right? We can actually look at the network, and then, if you had access to bank balance sheets, for example, you could see that it was because, AIG got into trouble that this other party holding a lot of their paper got into trouble, okay? So actually, There is an interesting paper about the effect of transmission of these kinds of financial shocks that is actually kind of a biography. Okay, and it's written by John Giannakopoulos, who actually kind of was involved in running a kind of a firm that repackaged mortgage that went out of business, not in 2008, but with the what was it, 1990? What was the 90? The thing about there was a crisis, a financial crisis. There was a kind of a long-term capital management.
Long-term.
Yeah, right. So there we seem to know that something happened to long-term capital management and this had a cascading effect. And John was involved in a firm that actually got wiped out because of that cascade. And he's pretty clear that he can identify. So the question that you're asking is really kind of a historical question in some sense. You need to go back and actually look at the story of the collapse in more detail. I think it's hard to answer that question in general, because I think that models really need to be kind of tightly fitted to the kind of phenomena that you're talking about. And a financial market contagion model is going to look very different than a crime wave contagion model. And I'm not sure that there's anything that could be, there's not a generic way of answering your question that would account for both.
Yeah, my question is kind of like, in this crime network example, it's very intuitive. Clear that individual network will work in a way that we're talking about. But in bank, it's like if AIG fail, then its impact on other banks will, you can look at in a way that the impact of this failure of AIG will impact the price in the market, and then the price will impact other banks' behavior. It's not less necessarily from,
No, that's right. But if you actually had access to balance sheet data,
right,
you could actually answer that question, right? So the real question you want to ask is, how can I identify that without balance sheet data? And I think the answer to that question is good luck. All right. Let me talk about another model of random graphs, just to show that there is more than one. This is a preferential attachment model. Is a model that was introduced back in the early 1920s by some mathematicians, but was popularized by how many of you have heard of Zipf's law? A few of you have, right? And how many of you have heard of Herbert Simon? Now, this is really a shock, right? Thank you. Right. Herbert Simon actually won a Nobel Prize in economics, right? Okay. And how many of you heard the phrase bounded rationality? Right? Okay. Connect that with Herbert Simon. Okay. But Herb Simon actually was a remarkable scholar who worked in a number of different areas, right? He worked in computer science and he worked in psychology. Touched on economics, and he's just kind of a Renaissance scholar, a Renaissance social scientist. Well, more than a social scientist. So, he also popularized preferential attachment models as a way of talking about some features of wealth distribution back in the 1950s. And these are, if those of you who are interested in city size or wealth distribution, you should go back and read the source material. So what's the idea of the preferential attachment model? Number one, think about co-authorships, right? How many of you all are busy writing papers. One of the things you have to do is you have to decide who are you going to cite, right? Now, of course, in some cases, it's obvious, right? I mean, you cite papers that you've relied on, right? But if you haven't yet figured this out, there's also something that we might call strategic citing. Right? Who's going to be the referee of this paper? And you might as well get in it first, because you know that if when that person turns out to be the referee, if you haven't cited them, they'll say, well, one problem with the paper is they haven't cited, blah, 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 right? So you know, it's good to fix that at the outset. So here's the idea. This is there are many different kinds of preferential attachment models. The idea of preferential attachment is that we're going to build a graph by a process, and those nodes that already have lots of links are going to be more likely to attract links from new nodes as we add them to the network. Okay? So what's the first thing you do when you dive into a literature is you read the popular papers, right? You read the major papers, which, how do we know they're major? Because they have lots of cites. And then when you write your paper, what do? You cite those papers. That's preferential attachment, okay? And so now the question is, if we build a random graph, or you know, that way, what is it going to look like? So here's a particular model. If we have a vertex set V of size n, what we will do is we're gonna order the nodes from 1 to n. There's going to be vertex 1, vertex 2, vertex 3. So we're going to take vertex 1. Vertex 1 is the first guy in our graph. Now we take vertex 2. Okay, and we're going to flip a coin. And if it comes up heads, we're going to choose one of the preceding nodes. Okay, for vertex 2, there's only one. Okay, and we will establish a link. Okay, when we get to vertex 3, okay, if the coin comes up heads, he will choose one of one or two at random and link to that one. Okay, and with probability 1 minus p, you're going to just link to the immediate ancestor. What's going to happen? So let's imagine. So this means essentially that vertex 2 is going to link to vertex 1 with probability 1. If the coin comes up heads, we're in the first case, but there's only one there. And if the coin comes up tails, we're in the second case, but the immediate ancestor is 1. So we're going to get a link with probability 1, right? And then as we run this process out, we are going to construct a connected graph, okay? Because everybody's going to—you're always making a connection. The question is: are you making it to your immediate ancestor, or are you making it to kind of someone chosen at random from everybody who's already there? And the result of this is everybody actually has only one link going out, right? But you might have a lot of links coming in. Right, so it's the in degree, the number of links coming into you, that's interesting, and the point is that is a power law distribution. The fraction of vertices with r edges converge, you know, in them converges as n gets large to something which is proportional. That's what that capital theta means. For those of you who are not familiar with that notation, converges to something which is proportional to r to some power, which depends upon p, okay? Just to show you a picture, here's what preferential attachment graphs look like. There are many different ways of generating preferential attachment graphs, and I don't know whether this picture was drawn by exactly that process, but this is what they look like in general. And the point is that you get a short head and a long tail. You can see that this doesn't look like an exponential, which would be going up steeper and kind of diving down a little more quickly, right? And you know, the key thing about power law distributions is that moments of high enough powers don't exist, right? okay, so... All right. So let's actually talk about what some real social networks look like. And we're going to do this, and then we will take a break. Okay. I will cut my short lecture. You know, I won't go into lunch because I shouldn't do this. This comes from a paper which the sociologists in the room should be familiar with by Peter Behrman at Columbia, James Moody. And I don't know who Stovall is. Do you know? You're a sociologist, right? Wasn't someone over here said they were sociologists? You were.
Yeah. Right.
Who's Stovall? Is it Jim Stovall? Is that right?
I know Berman and James Wood.
Right. Yeah. The graduate student, right? Okay. So, all right. So this is a data that comes from a high school. And I thought I had something, some more stuff on this here. A network of social relations. So they went into a high school and they asked, who are you dating? I don't know whether the question, whether it was actually a sex question or whether it was a dating question. I don't recall. Do you recall?
It must be sex because they used ad health.
Yes. That's right, but they supplemented the ad health data by actually going back into a school. And they didn't, this is not an, I don't think that this is, I'm a little confused. I would have to actually check my notes in more. I have it here, but I'm not going to dig it out. Okay. But and I think you're right. I think it is sex, because the point was actually to talk about why the transition of STDs in juvenile populations might look very different from STDs in adult populations, right? And the answer to that question is that the nature of the graph of sexual contacts looks different, okay? So here we have a graph, and you can see that it has some of the features that we've talked about. You'll notice that we have 63 dyadic pairs. We have 12 of these, 9 of these, okay? There is a giant connected component, okay? All right, and within those, and if we think about the degree distribution, again, we see that there are a few individuals that have very large degree, okay? But that the graph, a graph theorist looking at this graph would say that it is tree-like, okay? Why is that? Because, you know, there is this kind of big loop, but, you know, if you cut this loop at one point, you'd essentially have a tree with lots of branches going out in different ways, right? So it's a rather sparse graph, okay? But the point is that because of the structure, right, it's very possible to get, right, contagion chains, right, that could actually be quite long, right? And that's kind of the point of this picture. The most surprising thing about this graph is that there are no short, you know, there aren't very many. We have a big cycle here, right? But there aren't very many short cycles. In fact, there aren't any short cycles in this graph, right? And they spent a lot of time in the paper talking about why that would be the case. And another thing to notice is that the diameter of this graph is actually quite large, right? If you look at the giant component, the diameter is actually 37, okay? So the spans, you know, a lot of individuals having a long chain. This is actually there's a phrase for graphs. This is actually something that looks like what's called the spanning tree. And if you want to know more about spanning trees, you can kind of, that's what Wikipedia is for. Okay. So what are different kinds of models that you might look like, graphs that you might look like if you were thinking about you know, worrying about, say, the contagion of disease or something like this, or flow of rumors in a network, right? Or diffusion of behavior in a network, right? The diffusion of to choose an all too contemporary example, the diffusion of violent activity in a network, okay? There are several different graphs that are gonna have very different properties for the spread of disease. We have a core infection model. And a core infection model apparently is what characterizes, and I don't have a citation for, actually, I don't have a citation for this, but I have a long conversation with a friend who's written on this quite a bit, says that core infection models actually describe adult sexual contact networks. That there's a group of people who are very sexually active, and then a lot of people who aren't so active, but some of their activity will intersect this core, okay? And that has one implication for, you know, that says that in order to, the implication of this is that if you really want to stop a disease, you need to find the core, right, and get in there. On the other hand, at the other extreme, we have the spanning tree, which looks a lot like the, you know, the network that we just talked about. And here, you know, the nice thing about this is to stop an infectious chain, you just need to cut the tree, right? And that might be an easier task. There are other models out there that have different implications for the diffusion of behavior or diffusion of information. Or a phenomena actually that the sociologist Ron Burt has written about quite a lot has to do with people who bridge distinct groups and the power that accrues to them or doesn't accrue to them because of this position. For him it does. And so this is a very stylized picture of that kind of thing. And here, of course, just separate the populations. It's really easy. You just break one link. So these are different kinds of social networks that people have, you know, that you see in different settings. And I think, all right, here's another social network. And the point of this social network is simply to say, this is another study by Jim Moody, actually, and I think this is another middle school study, I think. The point of this is to say that, you know, we talk a lot about the networks and the network topology and all that, but we also have to remember that nodes in the network have characteristics. And this has a lot to do with the structure of a graph. So what he did here was to label, this graph is constructed, and this picture was drawn in a particular way. By the way, there is a real art to drawing these kinds of pictures so that they actually say something, okay? This is econometrics by eyeball, okay? And here, I think this is some, I don't remember the years, but these are an older class and a group of maybe like eighth graders and seventh graders or something like that, I don't recall. But the older class is on the top, the younger class is on the bottom, that's where the nodes are, and then the colors indicate different ethnicities, okay? And then the graph was drawn in such a way, subject to the constraint of putting the old on top and the young on the bottom, the graph was drawn so as to make the path lengths as small as possible, you know, the visual path lengths, which kind of basically highlights the clustering that goes on in the network. And what you see here is that ethnicities really cluster, okay? And age clusters. That's why we have the donut here, right? I've kind of lost a little time this morning, and I would have more to say about this. But again, I think that the article is a nice read, and it's worthwhile to go back and do that on your own if you're interested in this kind of thing. And I think for economists, it's kind of obvious that it's hard to say much if you actually don't know anything about the nodes, right? And this property of clustering by characteristics, again, is a common feature of social networks. There's a name for it, it's called homophily, and we'll talk about that more after the break. So now what I want to do is I want to talk about some things that we might, well, actually a couple of things that we might want to measure on networks. I guess I'll mention very briefly something I mentioned before, that we believe that a property of social networks that's important to social networks is this idea of transitive closure of the graph, namely that if A is connected to B, if A and B are linked and B and C are linked, then A and C should be linked as well. And there are several reasons why we might expect this to be true in social networks. One example that I've already mentioned is that, you know, we tend to hang with people who are like us, right? And so there's a name for this, it's called homophily. If you're my friend, it's likely that you are somehow like me. And if she's your friend, then it's somehow likely that she's like you, and therefore she's, you know, like me, you know, maybe to a smaller degree, but still like me, and therefore that homophily that we share makes it again more likely that we might be connected. Another reason why has to do with constraints. Economics is really about constraints, right? Okay, and so with constraints, it's that, you know, who is it that we get to meet, right? We don't get to meet everybody in the world, and so the opportunities for linking, we don't really have an opportunity to link with everybody in the world. And consequently, if the set of people who we could potentially meet with is small, right, then we're going to see a lot of transitive closure just because the opportunity set is so small, right? And if I want to make links, if I want to make friends, it's not, you know, and I don't meet that many people, and I've met you, it's likely that the set of people that you have met overlap with or have the potential to link with overlap with me to a large degree, and therefore, consequently, it's not surprising that we should have a lot of links in common, third links in common, and that again is transitive closure. There's another sociological theory that I don't really understand very well, and so I won't talk about it, but there's an old idea of something called latent stress in a network. And this is a reason that transitive closure is supposed to be relaxing some kind of stress in the network. I'll just mention that and then move on, so that there's a sociologist in the room that could say, well, you know, and there is. You'd say, well, you should be familiar with this, or you should at least mention this. And now I have mentioned it, but I'm not familiar enough to say anything intelligent about it. Now what I want to do is I want to talk about another important topic, which is centrality, okay? So if we go back and think about that preferential attachment picture that I showed you, right, we saw that there were some people who were clearly central, right? You know, that maybe I should go back and just remind you. Not that you need reminding, but where is it, right? We have these people who are at the centers of these clusters, right? Right. These are clearly, whatever centrality could mean, these people are somehow central in a network, right? But what about when we get to a graph like this? Well, you know, probably people here are not too central, but what does centrality mean in the big component, okay? Well, there's a sense, you know, in which we can see some high degree individuals in the large component, right? So maybe that's what centrality should mean. On the other hand, we can see a lot of individuals in the component of low degree who, if they disconnect themselves, right, dramatically change the topology of the network, right? And so maybe that's what centrality should mean, right? So, you know, people talk a lot about centrality in the network, but there are a lot of different centrality measures that correspond to a lot of different number of different concepts of what centrality could mean. And here are four measures that have been proposed, and some of these are important in economics research. So, for example, eigenvector centrality has appeared in several papers that Eleonora Potocchini and Yves Zanou have written. There's a paper looking at school attainment, you know, school achievement that was published in the Review of Economic Studies that they wrote that makes use of eigenvector centrality as an organizing principle. And we'll see that in an economic model itself shortly. So here are several types of centrality measures. People talk about degree centrality, and degree centrality is obvious. How many vertices can a vertex reach directly? The most central individuals are those with the highest degree. Between this centrality, how likely is a given vertex to be on the geodesic, the shortest path between two randomly chosen vertices? Okay. Now, for every other notion of centrality, I could think of an economic model where that might play. I've not written them down, but I could imagine an economic model where that would play a role. I can't imagine a role for between the centrality, because it seems to me that, you know, that while it's true that data might have the, you know, say rumors or something, might have the best chance of transmitting along the shortest path. If there are many, many other paths that are, say, one step longer, right, the probability of connecting from, say, A to B isn't really going to depend upon the shortest path, right? So it's not clear. So whether between the centrality is important is going to depend a lot upon other structures within the graph. So is there anyone in the room who's a game theorist, by the way? No one's raising their hand. Okay, because I have a thought about between this centrality and stochastic stability, but it's not worth sharing. you know, the two of us could have this really arcane conversation. All right. Closeness centrality. How fast can a given vertex reach all vertices in the network? So now what we're we can look at what is the mean distance from me to any other node in the network, or what is the maximal distance from me to any other node in the network, and use that, whatever that those numbers, one or the other of those numbers, as a measure of centrality. Eigenvector centrality is pretty important. Some of you probably know. How many of you have heard the phrase eigenvector centrality? Right? Okay, a couple of you have. How many of you have heard of something called PageRank? A few more. How many of you have heard of something called Google? And a lot of people are still lying because their hands aren't going up, right? So Google uses essentially, well, the original PageRank, Google uses algorithms that are based on something called PageRank. Now it's much more sophisticated than that, right? Probably for all, you know, since it's all secret inside that big building, right? We don't know what they do anymore, right? They probably have technology from Mars. But when they started, right, they, you know, were using this algorithm that actually made, that looked at eigenvectors of the incidence graph of the web, okay? And the idea of and so that is essentially, you know, what is and so they're essentially looking at measures of eigenvector centrality. Eigenvector centrality was first proposed by a sociologist in the at UCLA in the late, I think it was in the late 1970s, or maybe early 1980s. I forget which. Because there's and because I have two papers in mind and I don't remember which is which, but the idea is that a vertex is central if it influences a lot of central people, okay? And if you think about that and write down an equation that expresses that, right? What you actually get is an equation that says find an eigenvector of the centrality matrix, okay? Now you might say, wait a minute, because if this is an n by n matrix, there are lots of eigenvectors out there. Which one do we want? We probably don't want the ones that are complex vectors, right, with complex numbers. Of course, if it's a symmetric matrix, right, then all the eigenvectors will be real. But we want the positive one. And there's a theorem, right? How many of you know about something called the Perron-Frobenius theorem? Okay, one person, right? Two people, right? So there's a whole theory about non-negative square matrices, and if we have a non-negative square matrix that has a couple of other properties that would be reasonable for us to think about in this context, and you're going to say, well, I have a problem. The two of you who know about this are going to say, well, what about irreducibility? And I would say, well, we should really do this component by component, okay? And that would solve that problem. So there are a couple of assumptions that are, given my comment, plausible to make. And if that were true, then the following fact is true. The for non-negative square matrix satisfying these properties, there is the eigenvector of maximal modulus is unique, it is real. The corresponding eigenspace is one-dimensional, and it is a positive eigenvector, and all other eigenvectors have negative, you know, are, there's no other eigenvector corresponding to any other eigenvalue that has negative, that has only positive elements, right? And so that would be the one that we want. So you want, you know, you want to find the eigenvector corresponding to the Perron eigenvalue, and that's you know, and so that's what eigenvector centrality is. We're going to talk about this in some detail now and I want to look at some other related measures. All right, so let's formalize these different ideas that we've had, that I've mentioned. If we have an incidence matrix, and I'm going to imagine now, I'm going to think both about weighted incidence matrices and regular incidence matrices, because I think that, you know, that, well, let me just say that's what I'm going to do. So degree centrality, how would we read that off an incidence matrix? If we just look at individual J, and we imagine now we're looking at undirected graph, okay, what we want to do is look at the, we just want to sum across the row, because Aij is going to be 1 if there's a link between I and J. So if we sum across the row, if we sum across J's down J's column, right, there's going to be, if there's an IJ link, there's going to be a 1 in the ith element of the jth column. If there's no link, it's going to be a 0. So the sum of that is going to be the number of links. Okay, so that's degree centrality. Okay, there's another measure of centrality proposed by a guy named Katz in the early 1950s. He said, how many nodes can a given node reach? Okay, so think about the incidence matrix. Let's imagine that we have so we know what does the incidence matrix do? It tells us if there's a link between I and J. Okay, so now let's think about the square of the incidence matrix. Okay, so the square of the incidence matrix, what is the ijth element of the square going to be? It's going to be the sum of the following products, aij, or aik times akj. Okay, that sum is going to be zero if either aik or akj is zero, and it's going to be one if and only if both of those numbers are one. If both of those numbers are one, you've got a two path, right? But from a path of length two from I to J, okay. So when we do the whole sum, what are we getting? We're getting all the paths of length two. So the ijth element of A squared is the number of paths of length two between I and J, okay. And A cubed, same thing. The ijth element is the number of paths of length three, okay. So Kat said, well, what we should do is we should just sum up all of these paths. But what we should do is we should discount long paths, okay? And so that's what this sum does. We take this discounted sum of matrix products, of matrix powers, and the ijth element of this gives us a centrality measure. We have a family corresponding of centrality measures corresponding to different values of alpha. If alpha is very small, what are we doing? We're putting a lot of weight on short paths. Right, and if alpha is very large, right, we're putting more weight on long paths. Now there is a problem. It might be interesting in a given social network to actually compare centrality measures for different values of alpha, right? And if you just do this, it's not very helpful because as alpha gets bigger. And there's an upper bound beyond which this sum won't exist. And that bound is 1 over the largest eigenvalue, which we know is a real number, of the matrix A. Okay, if you make alpha larger than that, this sum will diverge. Right, the sum of matrix powers will diverge. You want alpha to be less than that. Now, as alpha approaches this critical number, all the centrality measures are, all the centrality numbers for all elements are just strictly increasing, right? So you can't really do a comparison. So what it would be natural to do, and the literature doesn't suggest this, but this seems an obvious thing to do, is to look at the average discounted value rather than the discounted value, which is to say to take this and look at and multiply it by 1 minus alpha, right? And that has the property. So think about present discounted values and average discounted value. If you have a stream of ones, right, and you take the present discounted value with, say, discount factor alpha, right, that sums to 1 over 1 minus alpha. If you look at the average discounted factor, the average discounted value, right, that's 1, because it's going to be 1 minus alpha times 1 over 1 minus alpha, right? And so that's kind of a way of normalizing as we change alpha, and that would be the appropriate thing to do here. And then what happens as alpha converges to this critical value is that you're converging to the infimum, the limit of the. Let's imagine the following series. Let's look at the average number of paths you have of length from 1 to t, say from length from 1 to l. Imagine how many paths of length 1, how many paths of length 2, up to length l, divided by l. Okay, and that series may or may not converge, right? But it always has a limit, and that average discounted value converges to the limit. And so it's a way of basically treating as alpha converges to this critical value. What that does is it says that we're counting long paths and short paths equally, okay? And so, which is what you might want to do in some circumstances. And so this is the Katz centrality. And you'll find lots of studies in the sociology literature that actually make use of Katz centrality as a way of talking about stuff. So here's eigenvector centrality. The centrality of J is proportional to the sum of the centralities of the nodes that J influences, right? And I've just written out that equation, and you can see that this is an equation that says that the centrality vector should be an eigenvector of the matrix A. Okay? And now we know the Bonisich papers in 87. Okay. I don't want to talk about this slide, but what I want to say is that there's a lot of connections between all of these different centrality measures. Okay. And you're going to have access to these notes, so you can study all this stuff on your own if you want. This is actually gives you a nice way of. There's a connection. Well, let me just move on. All right. So here's kind of the a way of understanding some of the relationships between these centrality vectors. If we look at the Katz centrality vector. And we for alpha, and we divide it by the Katz centrality vector. We multiply it by 1/(alpha), and then let alpha go to 0. That converges to the degree centrality. Okay. We take Katz centrality, and we let I'm just going to tell you what this is. I thought I might have the time to actually go through this, and of course I don't. Let me tell you what the answer is. The following: this matrix CE is a diagonal matrix whose ith element, whose ith diagonal element is the eigenvector centrality of person I, and it's the rest is zeros. Okay, and it so happens that if you take that matrix. And you pre-multiply it by the corresponding eigenvector, okay? Then that gives you the limit as beta alpha converges to its the upper bound of the convergence regime. It converges to the average discounted value of Katz centrality actually converges to this number. Now, when is that interesting? That's interesting in particular when you want to look at graphs that talk about at models that talk about learning. Kind of a popular learning model, and one that we might talk about in 20 minutes or so, is one that that says you look at the you average the beliefs of your of the people around you, right? And they're averaging, of course, the beliefs of the people around them. So as we step this process, right, we're averaging, and then we're averaging, and we're averaging. And what happens in that, if we write down that model where we're actually taking an average of the individuals around us, the corresponding eigenvector, the Perron eigenvector, is a vector of all ones. Okay? And so in that case, this V is just the identity matrix. And for many social influence models that have this averaging properties, and the kind that Stephen has written about in many of his papers are models of this kind, and the kind that I've written about as well, where you're averaging over individuals, okay? So that V is one, and in those models, essentially for those matrices, the Katz centrality converges to the eigenvector centrality as you converge to the upper bound. So this, I think, is when I worked this out, a couple of years ago, I thought this was very useful because I wanted to understand how we might kind of move back and forth between these different measures of centrality and what they're actually measuring. By the way, I found some texts that actually talk about this, and they get the math wrong. So you should actually work through it. Maybe I got it wrong, but I don't think I did. But you should, I have a lot of ego up here. You might check for yourself, but it does seem that that these measures might not be the way I think about this. Is that these measures are not as different as you might have thought, okay? I think actually, all right. Let me talk about one more notion of centrality, okay? And this is called alpha centrality, and this is also due to Phil Bonisich, right? And he says, so alpha centrality says the following. It says, centrality actually comes from two places. It comes, number one, from who you connect to, right? Or who's connected to you. And it also comes from what you bring to the table, okay? So maybe, for example, you're not terribly well connected to people, but you have a really rare piece of information, a very valuable piece of information, okay? Well, that makes you kind of important, right? Centrality should somehow reflect that. And this idea leads to the first equation on this slide, okay? And then when you solve for, and what this says is that the alpha centrality, when you have this vector d of what you bring to the table, is the sum of your something, you know, of your eigenvector, well, something that looks like your the centrality that you get from the network, plus this number d, your kind of freestanding or independent centrality. And you solve all of that out. And then, of course, you know, we have this idea with the c is equal to alpha c a. We have this idea here that, again, you're important if you're connected to important people. So we have both of those things going on. We solve that out, and we get this expression, which I've described in the third equation here. And when people report on alpha centrality, they typically take E to be the unit vector of all ones. And this seems to me to be silly, because the whole point was, and the way that Banasich introduces this idea is to say, well, you bring something to the table, right? That you know, you have some independent centrality, some independent power yourself. So, you know, why would you necessarily want to assume that that's all equal, right? It's not clear. But this is, in fact, what's done. And in fact, he was also the guy who did this. This is a little bit, you know, a little bit odd. So let me show you an example of why an economist should care about this measure. So here's a game, okay? It's going to be played on a network, all right? And I have to choose an action. Player I has to choose an action from the real line. And the utility that he gets from this action depends upon both what he chooses and on what his neighbors choose, okay? Now, there's two parts. So this part here, we can think of a private component as a private component of utility. And that's to say that if you were left to yourself, if you were ignoring your neighbors, if beta were equal to 0, you would choose xi equal to hi. Okay, that's a nice utility function, max at hi, right? On the other hand, of course, there's a social component, and what this says is that what are we measuring here? We're measuring the mean squared distance from your neighbors' choices in the network, and we're going to give those weight beta, okay? And of course, the farther, and I've set this up so that the farther away you are from your neighbors, the worse off you are. So there's a tension. You want to match your neighbors, but you also want to choose the what's best for you, okay? So let's look at the Nash equilibrium of this game. It's easy to compute. You've all done it already while I've been talking, right? And the answer turns out to be that it turns out to be right here. Oops, that's not, the answer is Chicago, okay? So X, the vector of actions, useful thing to do is to reparametrize this and look at this parameter phi, which is beta divided by 1 plus beta. Important thing to notice is that it's less than 1. How am I going to compute this average? Well, I'm going to look at this weighted average. It's going to be a weighted average of what my neighbors do. So some neighbors are more important than other neighbors, right? But again, the sum of those weights is going to be equal to 1 because I'm taking an average, right? And so this inverse is always going to exist, and 1 minus phi times 1 minus phi A inverse times H is going to tell us that's what X is going to be. Now, that actually has a nice interpretation, okay? If I look at, how is that, so if I want to look at the average play in the population now, what do I want to do is I want to sum all of this up and I want to divide it by n, right? So that's the same as taking the unit vector of all ones, pre-multiplying x by that vector, and then dividing by n. And if you do the arithmetic, you see that what we get is this weighted cat centrality, okay, times h, okay? So it turns out that the cat centrality, right, actually is a way of expressing what the Nash equilibrium of this game is, right? What's important, why do you want to know this? Well, this actually tells you one individual is going to have the biggest effect on the average play of the population, right? So individual eyes effect on the on the population is proportional to his average discounted value cat centrality. Okay, and what do I mean by effect? I'm now saying if we perturb his H a little bit, his HI, how does that change the behavior of the whole population? Okay, and to answer that question, you want to look at this average discounted value cat centrality. Okay, so there's a connection between something you've never heard of before and something that please tell me you have heard of before, namely Nash equilibrium. Okay, all right. So let's move on and talk about something else. I learned all of this from Stephen. Right? This is the bottom here, this is the typical epigraph for one of Stephen's papers. It's longer than the text. The text is one equation, it's very deep. Okay. So homophily, something I've referred to before, is this idea that that like associates with like. Okay. And many of you will recognize this, of course, as a map of Chicago, right? I think this is us. No, we're here, I think, right? Is that right? Right? Or are we down here? Well, we're here, right? Yeah, and you know, here are the bad guys, the other guys. Right, we know who they are. Right? That's Chuck Mansky up there. Right? This is Mansky, right? This is Heckman. That's Heckman, right? So, you know, I lived here for a while, but the only part of Chicago I ever learned, right, was this part. This part. I never could figure out the rest of the city, except for where Comiskey was. We don't call it Comiskey anymore. I don't even know what we call it. So what is this map? So you all are familiar with the Chicago neighborhood map, right? Chicago is broken up into these neighborhoods. It was done by, these divisions were dreamed up by sociologists at U of C, I think in the 20s, is that right? Right. So this is a different map. And the way this map was constructed was the different colors correspond to different ethnic groups. And what the map maker did was to choose a location and then to look at the average ethnicity, if you will, of the 20 nearest houses, right? And then colored the dot accordingly, okay? And so this is something that cartographers call, not surprisingly, a dot map, okay? And what you see here, of course, is lots and lots of clustering, okay? And a lot of sharp boundaries. Up here, there are some not so sharp boundaries, right? But a lot of the boundaries are really pretty sharp. Now, what's interesting, I should have put this into the notes because I was speaking here. He also did a similar map where instead of coding by ethnicity, he coded by income, okay? And again, you have a map that shows a lot of stratification, but much less stratification to my eyeball econometrics than you actually see for ethnicity. And that to me is I think that is a bit surprising. And of course, it may well be that, you know, then thinking about housing, we really don't want to code by income, we want to code by wealth, right? And maybe if we had wealth, the picture would be different, okay? I don't know, interesting question. If you ask me tomorrow, I will have the reference, or I can even dig up the map and show it to you, and then we can ponder together, okay? Okay, so what are the sources of homophily? And I'm now, you know, thinking about like an economist rather than like a sociologist. And I see three sources of homophily. One is what sociologists call status homophily, that we feel more comfortable when we interact with others who are like us in our various characteristics. Value homophily. This is a quote from some paper, and I should have put quotation marks and put the name of the author down there. I'll have to dig that up too. We often feel justified in our opinions when we are surrounded by others who share the same beliefs. We could actually extend that to actions as well, that we often feel comfortable with others who act like we do. Okay, and we see that idea going on in a lot of economic models of network formation, okay, where You know, and the big question of network endogeneity, right, is am I choosing my neighbors? You know, are my neighbors influencing me to act a particular way, or am I choosing my neighbors because they act the way that I act, right? Okay. Finally, there's something that doesn't really appear in the literature, so I have named it opportunity homophily. We mostly meet people who are like we are, and consequently, this is a constraint that is a source of homophily. Now, here is a diagram from a rather famous study done by Nick Christophe and Jim Fowler. And this is the famous obesity study. Have you heard of this, right? About how obesity is alleged to be contagious, right? How many of you believe it? Yeah, right, okay, yeah, and that's kind of about right. It's not like zero, you know, but it's also not like catching a cold, as I seem to have done, right? I know my vector. I got this from my wife. In this picture, and I actually need to look at the notes. This is actually a great study for thinking about the confounding effects of homophily in trying to identify social interactions. So the Christakis and Fowler paper. I think this was published in. Was it Nature? It was in 2007, and I think it might have been in Nature. I think that's where I got this from, but I'm not sure. So the purple lines, you'll notice that links are different colors. And purple lines are genetic links. Size of a node in this picture is proportional to body mass index, okay? Yellow being obese, green being not obese, according to a definition. Red-rimmed nodes are female, nodes without a red rim are male. And what they did was to study, this data comes from a long-standing panel data set. It's called what the Framingham something, and it was actually started in the 1940s, late 1947, I think, to study cardiac stuff. And it is a panel, and so it's a multi-generational panel by now, right? And so it's a great data set, and you can, with great difficulty, actually get your hands on it. Okay, you know this? Have you worked with it?
Yeah, epidemiologists love the
program. Ah, so you do work with it. Okay.
I mean, it's all health outcomes.
Mm-hmm. So. Okay. Okay. So I know an economist who actually managed to get a hold of it, and that was. So that means there's hope for all of you. Right? And what they did was, you know, so you have it's this great panel, and so you can actually look at the dynamics of this. And so again, what we're going to, you know, what we are supposed to notice in this picture is clustering again, okay, on body mass index. And now the question is, why do we see this clustering? Right, so it could be that we see this because of selection of links, that people choose their friends to match their weight. Okay, it could be that we see this clustering because of homophily on an unobserved attribute of individuals, right, that's highly correlated with weight. Okay, so the weight is not the causal factor, but it's correlated with something that is. Then we can actually imagine mechanisms for there being social contagion going on. The changes in friends' weight affects your own view of weight. And so that would, you know, leading to the, that's the contagion idea, right? Having said all of that, I will say that there's a lot that's wrong with this research. And that there is a very nice paper by a student of Stevens, Ethan Cohn Cole, and a co-author whose last name is Fletcher. I don't remember his first name, but you do.
Jason
Fletcher, right? And the citation is in the notes, and it's a very careful taking apart of this research, and so you might take a look at that. But before you do, you should take it apart on your own, right? And then, you know, and then see if you do better or worse than Ethan and Jason did. Okay, all right. So this is a nice story within which to think about the econometric consequences of homophily And that's all I wanted to say about it. I don't want to talk a lot about the epidemiology of obesity. Okay. Measuring homophily, there are many different ways to measure homophily. It seems that they all have, all the ways that I have seen in the literature, they do different things, but they start with the same basic idea, which is to say that they all reduce to pretty much the same thing, that when you have two individuals, when you have two types. And what happens when you have more types? It gets more complicated. But the idea here is if you have a network with N individuals, what you can do is imagine that types are assigned to individual randomly. Okay, so suppose that you've got two types in the population, and fraction p is type 1 and 1 minus p is type 2. So first imagine that you assign types randomly to this network. Then you can compute the probability of a cross-type link. Okay, and now what you could do is you could go out and measure, right, the probability of a cross-type link in your data, the fraction of cross-type links in your data, and to the extent that they differ, that's evidence of clustering. Okay, and then you can do this in a variety of different ways, depending upon what kind of modeling of clustering that you might have, and so on and so forth. This literature gets pretty sophisticated, but this is the basic idea. Let me now talk about having talked. So I now want to talk about another phenomena some sociologists have keyed on in trying to understand the social setting of market behavior. And I want to do this in the context of labor markets, because this is where it seems to come up. I have some data on labor markets, but everybody in this room knows, right, that we have lots of inequality and that labor markets are important for studying inequality. So we'll skip all of that. And now what I want to do is talk about job search. Okay, So here is a table that comes from a paper from a fellow named James Montgomery, who has a PhD in economics, right, but decided to lower his salary by taking a job in a sociology department. Okay, and he's in the sociology department at the University of Wisconsin, where he might or might not have a courtesy appointment in your apartment. He does, yes. So this is a table from a paper that he published in the American Economic Review, right? So here we have a number of different studies that were done, and the point of this table is just to observe that most people do not get jobs by what you might call over the transom applications, right, or under the door applications, right? That referrals seem to be of some kind seem to be very important, right? The density of the print in the first column, right, demonstrates this, right? So this is kind of an established fact about labor markets, right? That friends, relatives are important ways of looking for many different kinds of jobs. And I think actually what's surprising about this is that you see this in many different kinds of jobs. You see this in a forklift operator, you see this in an accountant, you see this in managerial jobs, right? So this is kind of like up and down, up and down the ladder, okay? Mark Granovetter is a sociologist at Stanford, and he wrote let me get to my notes first. Okay. What Mark did was to write on how individuals actually found jobs. Right. He did some survey research, and he had an idea. The key idea that he had was the following: that individuals that we can imagine there being a ties of a continuum of strength, and we're going to kind of break these down into two classes, strong ties and weak ties. And we might imagine that strong ties are people like close friends and family, and weak ties are people that we might see only occasionally or even know very vaguely or something like this. And he wrote an article called The Strength of Weak Ties, right? And the idea is that for a variety of things for which we might use networks, for which we might deploy networks, weak ties are very important, okay? So how do you define what it means to be a weak tie, Okay. So here he writes a little bit about this, about, you know, we look at time, emotional intensity, the intimacy of the relationship, reciprocal services, and then we take a why a linear combination? Who knows, right? How do you even measure these things, right? But these are the right things, okay. What he did actually in his study, so he did a study, he wrote a book called Getting a Job, and what he did was to survey managerial and professional types, job changers in Newton, Massachusetts, which, as you know, is a well-off suburb of Boston. And he asked those who found a new job through a contact. Okay, went to people who found new jobs through a contact, and he said, "How often did you meet with that contact?" So he was going to use "How often do I see you," right, as a measure of the tie strength. Okay, and then he also asked, "Where did your contact hear about this job from?" Now I don't know, whether he then I read the book a long time ago, and I don't recall whether he then went to the contacts and said, "Well, where did you hear about this job from?" Because what you'd really like to know is something about the length of those chains, right? And he reports something on that. But here's what he found. He said that when he asked where the how often did you see this person from whom you got the referral, the answers were 17% of the population said these were people I see often. 28% of the population actually said that they were these were people that I rarely see, and the majority, the residual probability, which is on the order of 55%, said these are people that I see occasionally, right? So, so this corresponds with his intuition that it's not the strong ties that are doing the work. Obviously, if ties are too weak, right, then, you know, fading into non-existence, then that's not going to be helpful. But the occasionally category was the majority. Then the question he asks is, well, where did these people hear about the job from, right? And he reports that, I see how to read that. Okay. He said that I have a bunch of numbers here that I can't quite read, but he said that very few people actually heard about the job from someone else who heard about the job. A path length of two, okay. He said the modal answer was that there was a path length of one, which is to say that 45% of the people who gave the referral didn't themselves know about the job, but heard about it from someone else, right? And the number, and that's 45% as opposed to 39% who actually knew about the job themselves. So in fact, the referrals came more often from people who didn't themselves know about the job directly or were the source of the information, but had heard it on referral, indicating again the importance of networks to this process, okay? So Granovetter goes on and has some theory about, there's a number of, this kind of thing has been replicated a number of times. Right, it's been replicated in Russia, for example, in the mid-2000s. Sociologist named Nan Lin actually did something very interesting with Chinese data that was published just a couple of years ago, wherein he looked at how did people find jobs and how has that changed over time with the reforms. And I should actually go and just look that up directly. Hang on just a second. No, I can't. Maybe it's at the end of this. Here it is, yes. So he had three cross-section surveys done at different times in China. And what he did was he looked at the use of ties in finding jobs over a period from 1978 to 2008. And what he found was that that there was no systematic difference in the use of weak ties for finding jobs over that period. But if you wanted to get a job in a state-owned enterprise, strong ties became increasingly important. Okay? which might you know, kind of agree with your theories of nepotism and things like that, right? But also, I think just, you know, indicates the importance of making the distinction no matter which way it goes. We might theorize about, you know, you might expect, for example, you know, in a more complicated world that weak ties might become more important. On the other hand, you know, we see that in this one particular kind of job searching activities, it's strong ties that have become more important. And that's an interesting thing to think about. So what I want to do very quickly is talk about how Granovetter's idea of why weak ties matter. And then I want to talk about how we can see in a labor market model, again, it's going to be a model due to Jim Montgomery, that ties and networks are important. So Granovetter has this idea that is, he says that if we have, so he wants to kind of build on the transitivity idea. And he wants to say that maybe if you've got two weak ties, right? I know this person from church, right? And I know this other person from the workplace, right? It's not so likely that there's going to be a tie between them, right? But if we're talking about two close friends of mine or two family members or a family member and another close friend, it's likely that they have a connection, right? So he says that triadic closure is more a property of strong tie relationships than it is of weak tie relationships, okay? That actually has implications for the topology of larger network construction. And what I want to do is I want to show you that really quickly. So here we have two cliques, okay? Yes, everybody's connected to everybody else, and I want to think about nodes A and B. Now, what are weak ties? What gives weak ties an advantage? The idea of weak ties is that if I talk to people who are strongly connected to me, they're likely to have the same information that I have. And if I talk to two people that are strongly connected to me, they're likely to have the same information. Each is likely to have the same information the other does. So I'm really not learning very much by multiplying my strong ties. Okay, but on the other hand, right, when I survey someone to whom I'm only weakly tied, their information is liable to be much more independent of mine, right, and therefore more valuable, right, in many, many different economic settings we can imagine, right? Okay, so so here we have these strongly connected clusters, or these connected clusters, and if we have two clusters like this, or two cliques like this, and then we draw a link between them, I'm going to call that link a bridge. Now, that link is actually very powerful, right? Because now stuff from the top right clique can get down to the bottom left, okay? It's kind of rare to imagine that we have a network where we have lots of these cliques, okay? One connection. So we can imagine, let's extend our concept and introduce the idea of a local bridge. And a local bridge is an edge where the corresponding nodes here and here have no common friends, okay? And so now here we have these two cliques connected by two local bridges. Okay, and now what I've done is I've labeled these weak and strong, and I've labeled these in a way that is consistent with Granovetter's idea that says that a length two path containing only strong edges is in fact a triad, so that if I have a triangle of two strong edges, say like oops, okay, like here and here, okay, then there should be a connection between them. So if we have this edge and this edge, well then we have this edge as well. Here it's connected by three strong edges. I think I have another example somewhere where. SS, yes. So up here we have strong, and here the tie connecting them is weak. Granovetter doesn't say whether that connecting edge is going to be strong or weak, but we do expect strong edges to be closed. Now, what's the implication for network topology here? The implication for network topology is the following. A local bridge has the property, okay, that there are no friends in common on either side of the bridge, right? And what that means is that this has to be a weak link, okay? If this were strong, okay, if this were strong, then you'd have a strong link from A to B, you'd have a strong link from B to D, so then you'd also have to have some kind of link from D to A, according to Granovetter's hypothesis, and this would no longer be a local bridge, okay? So that if our vision of the world is one of these cliques or strongly connected groups, or you know, densely connected groups is what I want to say, that are connected by a few individuals that bridge these gaps, okay, then, and if you buy Granovetter's hypothesis about the relation about tie formation, then those connections are going to be weak ties. And this illustrates then the important, if you imagine that there is some, you know, reason why you know a value in having additional stuff coming from here that isn't what's being rocketed around inside here, right, then you can now see why weak ties would be a valuable thing, okay? I want to talk now about a model of ties and inequality. We are at a summer school on social economic inequality. So here's a story about how networks have something to say about inequality. This is also a model due to Jim Montgomery. So here's the story. This is a very simple model. This could have been on a qualifying exam, right? So think of that, okay? Workers live for two periods, and the number of workers is identical in both periods. We have half of the workers are high ability workers, and they produce one unit of output per period. Half of the workers are low ability workers, and they produce zero. Workers are observationally indistinguishable. We can't tell, you know, who's who. At the moment of hiring, you don't know what kind of worker you're getting. We're going to imagine that each firm employs one worker. We're going to imagine that the market is extremely competitive, okay, so that workers are paid their expected marginal profit, and it's because of this free entry, risk-neutral entrepreneurs, profit to the firm is going to be, the profits are basically going to be distributed, expected profits are going to be distributed to the worker. So each firm employs one worker. What's the wage rate going to be? The wage rate is going to be expected productivity, right? And so, so what are profits to the firm going to be? I'm saying this all wrong. So let me start again and simply say that there's a wage rate out there that we're going to determine. Okay, it's not. The wage rate will only be expected profitability in some instances in this model. So let me be precise about that. There's a wage rate out there, and the firm's profit is going to be employee productivity minus the wage. So it's going to make one minus the wage if it hired a productive worker. It's going to make minus the wage. That's to say, it's going to lose money if it didn't hire a worker. If it hired an unproductive worker. In equilibrium, firms' expected profit should be zero, and wage offers you would expect would be expected profitivity. So now I'm going to build a little social structure into this model. I'm going to say that each time one worker knows at most one time two worker, and each and not all workers, a time one worker knows a time two worker with some probability. That probability is tau. But he knows only one. He doesn't have multiple ties. Okay, only one tie. Conditional on having a tie, it's to the same type with probability alpha, which is going to be greater than 1/2. So alpha is essentially a measure of homophily, of ability homophily. Okay, and tau is essentially a measure of the density of the network. Okay, in the simple network model. And the assignment, and given those constraints, the graph is going to be random, okay, given these constraints, okay. So what's going to actually happen here, by the way, is that one type 2 worker might have ties to multiple type 1 workers, okay. That, by the way, is a source of market power for the type 2 workers, okay. All right, so let's move on. What's the timing of the model? Firms hire workers through an anonymous market in the first period, and the market clears at some market clearing wage rate, okay? Then production occurs, and it would be nice if I could spell occur. Each firm learns its workers' productivity, okay, because it sees whether or not it got a unit of output, okay? Now comes time for the second period. The old worker can make a referral, right, of his or her friend to the firm. And so the firm sets a referral offer wage for a second period worker, okay? So if you come to me, right, and say I've got this really good young kid who will be perfect for your firm now that I'm about to retire, I will offer that guy a wage. And that will be different than the wage that I would offer, or it may be different, than the wage what I would offer if I draw from the anonymous worker market instead, okay? All right. Okay, so you can see the rest of the timing here. Social ties are assigned. Time one workers with ties relay the referral offer. Time two workers decide whether to accept the offer or enter an anonymous market. There are going to be other workers who never got a referral offer because they were not connected to anybody, right? Or maybe there's another reason why. Maybe they were referred by a bad guy, right? So, think about it. If I am more likely than not to know someone my type and I'm unproductive, then, you know, you might say, well, I'd rather draw at random, right? So for any one of those reasons, you might go into an anonymous market, and that market is going to clear at some market wage WM2, then second period production clears, where at the end of time, the market shuts down, okay? That's the model. It's pretty clear? Okay. So what do we find? Well, no surprise that only firms with high productivity workers are going to, in fact, make referral offers. Referral offers are going to be distributed on some interval, and there's a literature on this that comes from the 1970s having to do with why might we expect there to be deviations from the law of one price. And this is essentially due to the market power of the second period workers who get referrals, because some workers get multiple referrals. And I'm not going to go into why you actually get this, but there's a paper by a guy named Jerry Butters that was published in the Review of Economic Studies in 1977 that explains why you get this distribution. Montgomery just says C. Butters, okay? So I'm now telling you C. Butters. And it's not the South Park Butters, by the way, okay. The second period anonymous market wage rate is less than one half, okay? And why shouldn't it be less than one half, right? Because who's going to be in the anonymous market? People who, there's going to be several types of people. There's going to be people who just don't know anybody, right? And they're 50-50, good or bad, right? And then there's going to be people who know, right? People that all referral offers are going to be accepted, right? So then we have the other people in the market are going to be people who know people, but they're bad people. They themselves are more likely to be bad. So the expected productivity of a worker in the anonymous market is less than one half, and so therefore the wage rate should be less, okay? Second period profits to the firms will be positive. And what is the market? That's the expected period profit from production, okay? And that has an impact on the first period market wage. The first period market wage is now, in fact, going to be greater than one half. Why is it going to be greater than one half? Because the value of a worker is twofold, okay? First, the value of a worker is the value of its output. Second, the value of a worker is who he or she refers. Okay, so there is this information value that a worker has as well, and with probability one half, any worker has that. Okay, and so that increases the market wage rate in the first period. Okay, now the referral wage rate, of course, is higher than one half, and so now we get income inequality because of the sorting that goes on. Now there is an interesting question about whether you want to call this necessarily bad inequality, right? Because after all, it's efficiency sorting, in some sense, right? And so that's an interesting ethical dilemma, which I suppose, Stephen, you'll be talking about at some point. Or not. A little bit, yes. All right, so comparative statics, okay? When we increase the informativeness of the referral interval shifts up. The wage distribution for the referral offer shifts up. The market wage rate in the second period falls, okay? Also, the first period wage rate increases because now the referrals are more informative, right? Okay, so this all makes a great deal of sense, and the same is true about network density. Okay, network density is important again because why does the first period market wage grow up with network density? Well, a given worker is more likely to have a contact, right? He can't make a contact if he didn't connect with anybody. So social isolates are bad things to hire, right? But you're going to have less of them if the market if tau is a bigger number. So this is all, you know, I think it's very intuitive, right? And it demonstrates in a very simple way the informativeness of it demonstrates in a very simple way, I think, how the presence of, how even thinking about a social network of some kind can change, right, the market, you know, even in this competitive situation, kind of from away from the first order competitive wages, right? Which is the point of this. Now, you could also ask yourself, you know, what would happen if we had, you know, you could imagine playing with this model in a number of ways. Enriching the social structure in any one of a variety of ways, adding, say, stronger weak ties, things like this, and see how these different effects work out. But this is, again, a very simple illustration of why network structure matters for economic outcomes. Any questions before I go on? Yes?
I mean, this is kind of a version of the lemon market, right, where if you don't know exactly the information about the quality of the car, you will assume it's a bad car. And I would say that.
Well, you're not. I think that's not right here because you're not assuming it's a bad car. I mean, you know, you are assuming that it is a average car, which could be good or bad, right? It's not. You know, it's not. So the lemon's market story would be: I know I'm a good market, a good worker, and you're offering me this kind of market wage, which doesn't really reflect my ability. So I'm choosing to stay home, right? But that's not happening here. Everybody's going to work at whatever wage they can get, okay?
What I can see here is that the good quality people will try to seek referrals because that's the only way to distinguish them from the bad people.
Well, everybody would like to be referred, but there's nothing they can do. There's no action they can take to seek it, right? So there's no adverse selection going on here. In fact, you know, we forced it to be quite the opposite by saying that any referral is more likely, you know, is likely to be an informative referral, right? Whereas, you know, the adverse, it's just kind of the flip side. So making the connection to the lemon story, I think, is the right thing to do because it's kind of the flip side of that story. It's actually just the opposite. So it's a strong connection, but it just goes the other way, okay? So good intuition. I can talk a little bit about an econometrics model, you know, about how one might, you know, linear and means models and all of that. But I think I'd actually rather talk about something that I haven't talked about in these lectures before. I'd rather talk about social learning. So let me say one thing about linear and means and all of this. How many of you are interested in estimating social interaction models of some kind? One, yeah, like not too many of you, but a few of you are, okay, right? So how many of you have heard of the reflection problem? Okay, so how many of you can actually state what the reflection problem actually is? Yeah, only one hand goes up. You should be able to, right? Stephen's hand didn't go up, you'll notice.
But I was lying.
You were, like so many people in this room do, right? I have some notes that I would go through, and the bottom line of the notes is to say that the reflection model, the reflection problem that Mansky writes about is in fact an artifact of a very, very particular social network construction, okay? So, for example, if you want to look at peer effects in a classroom, and you assume that everybody in the single classroom is a friend of everybody else in the classroom, okay? Right? And everybody equally weights everybody else, right? The usual model, right? Now you have a framework where the reflection problem could arise, okay? Suppose, on the other hand, you had data from two classrooms, and the same was true, that everybody was friends with everybody else in their classroom, okay? But the two classrooms are of different sizes. No reflection problem, okay? If their two classrooms are the same size, there is a reflection problem, okay? Or there could be. Depends on other things going on as well, but there could be. But not if they're of different sizes, okay? So what does that suggest to you? That suggests to you that, wow, network structure is really going to matter, right, for thinking about the reflection problem. And it also turns out, and Stephen and I and other co-authors, Buzz Brock and Roger Jeremon, have written a model down and showed that, you know, for the typical network that you might choose to write down, right, you are not going to have this problem, okay? And in particular, you know, this problem really arises in part for, you know, because everybody treats everybody else in this network equally, in some sense, right? But, you know, if you have a friend that I don't have, right, and now we think about the social network model, well, that's an exclusion restriction right there. That has to help, right? We get enough of those, right, due to the network topology, and wow, now we're in business again for usual reasons of the kind that you learned when you studied linear simultaneous equation models, assuming you took an econometrics class that did that, okay? That's all. I mean, that would be the punchline of what I would want to say, right? Is that people come and give job market seminars where they talk about, here's how I'm handling the reflection problem, right? And in my department, those people don't get jobs because you look at their model and there was no reflection problem to begin with. And so if you weren't smart enough to actually check your model to see whether it was an issue, you don't get a job at Cornell, okay? And this has happened twice in recent years, okay? Maybe they were bad for other reasons too, but you know, that kind of carried the day in the meeting. And I would bet this happens at Wisconsin and other smart departments as well, right? So don't just, you know, kind of use the jargon and say, wow, okay, there's this thing that Mansky wrote about, so I've got to find out what's my solution to the reflection problem, right? What you should say is that, well, my model doesn't really have a reflection problem, right? And then tell us why, right? And actually, even a good answer would be, well, you know, most models don't. But you probably can't get away with saying that in the job talk. All right. Let me now advance to... Oh, okay. Let me talk a little bit instead. I really want to talk about social learning, but I'm not going to do it. I'm going to talk instead about matching and network formation. Okay. So I said at the beginning, sometime near the beginning, that there are essentially two distinct ways of thinking about network formation, right? One way of thinking about it is just to assume that there's some kind of data generating process, a random graph model of some kind. We assume some functional form and we go and estimate the thing, right? So examples of these are, there are things called exponential random graphs. A tradition in sociology that does this with Snyder's and who's the guy at UCLA who used to be at Washington? Mark.
Hancock,
right? Mark Hancock. So these guys are really good at this, right? There's a recent paper actually by Matt Jackson and one of his junior colleagues at Stanford that kind of introduces a random graph model that has particularly nice properties for ticking to data, right? And so these are exogenously given models. We don't, you know, we're taking the graph generating process as exogenous and then we estimate the thing. Or we use the thing to actually draw graphs from which we look at then behaviors on those random graphs, right? And that's a big tradition, by the way, in the mathematical literature on graph models. If you look at the mathematical epidemiological literature, they'll talk about things like, we draw a Bernoulli random graph. I'm really oversimplifying here. We draw a Bernoulli random graph, right? And now we can talk about, you know, the duration of an epidemic as a function of the probability p, or something like that, right? You talk about average lengths and things like that. So that's a whole line of research, right? Another approach is to actually think about how to build strategic models of network formation, right? Now, the problem with building a strategic model of network formation is, what's the game, Okay. So if you want to think about a game, you've got to talk about, well, what are the strategies available to individuals? Okay. What are the payoffs that come from the strategy? So on and so forth, right? And if we think about something like finding a spouse, right, or finding a partner, okay, well, who would dare to write down a game and say that, you know, Bayes-Nash equilibrium of this game describes marriages, right? We wouldn't really know how to do that, right? What is the strategy that one person employs in trying to induce another person to be his or her partner, right? And that's what the game theoretic approach, you know, doing a non-cooperative game would actually require, right? So economists have thought about ways to get around this. Okay, so I'm going to start by talking about matching problems. Okay, how many of you have studied the Gail Shapley marriage model, marriage paper? How many of you have heard of David Gale? Right? How many of you have heard of Lloyd Shapley? Like, yeah. How many of you have heard of Alvin Roth? Right? Okay. Like, more Roth than Shapley. This, just so you should know, by the way, that Robert Allman, how many of you have heard of Bob Allman? Not so many people. Okay. So then it won't be important to you to know that Allman, himself a Nobel Prize winner, says that Shapley was the greatest game theorist of the 20th century. Okay. So, and invented things like the core. Okay, so it's good to know this. Okay, what do I want to say? That matching problems of the kind that for example, Gale and Shapley talked about, are problems of network formation. And what we're trying to do in matching is that we have a bunch of say workers and firms, or we have since Gale and Shapley was written in the early 1960s, right? We have males and females, okay? And we want to match them up. And so we end up with a network, and that network is a particular kind of network called a bipartite graph. Bipartite graphs are graphs where we partition the nodes into two groups, and all edges are from group one to group two. And we can have n-partite graphs for any graph, that, you know, for any n that you would want to have. There is a literature on bipartite matching problems, and this is a simple way of talking about network formation. There's bipartite matching with transferable utility. Then there's bipartite matching without, and this is something that you probably studied in your theory class in the first year. Then there's bipartite matching without exchange. This is the Gale Shapley problem. And then there's the generalization of this idea to networks. And I want to get to that. And so I thought it would be easiest, actually, to talk about the idea of stable matches when we have transferable utility and when there's actually exchange going on. There is an in-between case, by the way, which very few people have written on, which is to say that we have bipartite matching with exchange but without transferable utility. Transferable utility means that we have a good like money, which everybody is linear in. Okay, and that gives rise to all sorts of special features, a variety of economic models, right? Essentially, it says that utility possibility frontiers are straight lines or hyperplanes, right? That allows you to do all kinds of things. So this intermediate case is, by the way, for anyone who is theoretically inclined, that's an interesting thing to think about, because I can think of only one or two papers that have explored that domain. There's clearly a lot to do. Low-hanging fruit is always good to pick. So let's suppose that there are two sets of objects, X and Y, workers and firms. Each side has preferences over whom they're matched with. But there's no externalities in matching. So, you know, if I'm matched with you, I don't care who you match with, right? It doesn't affect my utility. No offense. Right. So that's the story. And the literature, as I said, divides over the information parties have when they choose partners and whether compensating transfers can be made. But the organizing principle is that of a stable match. And so I want to take you through that idea rather quickly and then talk about its extensions to arbitrary networks and the problems and pitfalls of doing this. So a match is a one-to-one map from X to Y. And a match is stable if there are no pairs X, Y, that is matched, and X prime and Y prime that are matched with each other, where the one person from the first match and of course and the other person from the second match, the person of the other type from the second match, want to divorce their partners and move in together. Okay? So let me say that again. There are no pairs where X is matched with Y, X prime is matched with Y prime, such that Y prime wants to match with X, and X wants to match with Y prime. Let me say that better. Where Y prime prefers X to X prime, her match, and X prefers Y prime to Y, his match, right? If we have a match without those properties, if we have a matching where that phenomenon doesn't exist, that's a stable match. And this is an idea, as I said, which is due to Gale and Shapley, and it appeared in a paper. It was published in a journal for high school math teachers, okay? And it generated a Nobel Prize. There you go. And by the way, the paper concludes, you've read the paper, so you remember the concluding paragraphs, comments on the value of mathematics, right? The value of mathematics is not, you know, learning lots of formulas and stuff like this. The value of mathematics is learning to think clearly.
They don't even, like, use formulas in the paper.
Pardon? There isn't any formula in the paper. No, it's all chat, right? It's a beautiful paper. During lunch, if you ask me, I will tell you how it is that Lloyd Shapley changed my career by defeating every thesis proposal I ever had. he's a very smart man. All right, so let me take you very quickly through transferable utility matching, simply because this is the easiest to talk about. Okay. Actually, you know what? I'm not even going to do that because I really only have 5 minutes left. Okay. So, but this is in my notes, and you can read. And if you're interested in, if those of you who are interested in like labor market matching, this is the model you want to know, right? And there have been recent papers actually by Aloysius Hsiao and a co-author, right? 2006 JPE, for instance, on how to take these kinds of matching models to data. So maybe actually we should talk about this very quickly. So I will do this. It's also because I really love linear programming. How many of you have ever studied linear programming? None of you. Like two of you, three of you are willing to admit it, right? You know, I always thought linear programming was really boring until I discovered that I could teach about half of a microeconomic theory class just with linear programming. So we're going to imagine that every match has a value, and that is, do I set this up? I don't set this up, so let me say it here. VLF is the value that is generated by matching L and F. And this is a transferable utility model, so what these guys are going to have to do is to think about, should they match, right, how to distribute that value. That's going to be an issue, okay? we're going to decide, we have the set of L, the set of F, laborers and firms, a matching is a set of integers, zeros and ones. XLF is zero if there's no, if L does not match with F, and XLF is one if L does match with F, right? And we want to find the optimal match. What does it mean to, an optimal match says, oops, maximize the sum of values subject to the constraint that each worker matches with no more than one firm, and each firm matches with no more than one worker, okay, and that's it. Now, this is really a hard problem to solve because the variables involved are either 0 or 1, okay? So someone had the bright idea, well, suppose that we allow for fractional matches, right? Just say that, you know, that these variables can be any number between 0 and 1. They have to be non-negative, okay? And then we have these constraints, you know, here that are going to bound them. So suppose we allow for fractional matches. If we do that, now we have a simple linear program. Now, the interesting thing about the linear program is the following observation, which is a trivial observation with a very fancy name. This is called the Birkhoff von Neumann theorem. And when you hear those names together, you have to think, this must be really hard and really deep. Okay? And the Birkhoff von Neumann theorem says that, let me back up for a minute and say, you know, that if you think about linear programming, I'm going to draw a picture if there's chalk, and if not, we're going to fake it. Here's my one picture of the day. You know, a linear program says that you have a constraint set that's like a polyhedron, right? It looks something like this. And what it says, and the theory of linear programming says, among other things, that if you've got a solution, there will be a solution at one of these kinks, one of these vertices, okay? If you had a solution here, it's because the objective function looks like this. And so if this were a solution, all of these would be solutions, and in particular, you have kinks, right? Alternatively, you could have objective function that looks like this, where the only solutions at a kink. But you always have a solution at a kink, right? That's kind of the theory of linear programming. Well, what the Birkhoff von Neumann theorem says is that the constraint set, these constraints define some kind of polyhedron, and the kinks are all the integer solutions, all the 0-1 solutions. So if you find a solution, find a what's an extreme solution, a solution at a kink, it's called a vertex solution, or a basic solution, okay? And that will be a solution of zeros and ones, that's a solution to your problem, all right? So it says that now you can study linear program, and linear program is easy, you can look it up all over the place, and so that will give us a solution to the optimal match. Now, let's actually think about stability for a moment. We're gonna divide the surplus between workers and firms, okay? And so each worker has to get a certain amount, each firm has to get a certain amount. And stability says the following. It says there's not an unmatched worker and firm that prefer each other to their current partners. Well, how would they prefer each other to their current partners if they could form a match that would give them profit that they could split in such a way, right, that each would get a little bit more? Right? So we want that not to happen. Okay. So in particular, what's going to have to be true is if we have a division of the surplus which makes our match stable, okay, it's going to have to be the case that if we have I and F being matched and J and G being matched, then if we try to match I and G, the sum of what they're now getting now exceeds the value of what they could generate. And similarly for J and F, if they were to split, if J, worker J and firm F were to run off together, the value that they would generate would be less than the sum of what they're getting now. Okay, where am I going? Okay. All right, so that's the condition that we want. So here's the cool thing. Every linear program has a dual, okay? And, you know, I mean, any convex program has a dual. This is the same duality theory that you learned in micro theory about profit functions and production functions, or about utility and expenditure functions. It's all the same theory, okay? And the dual program for a linear program, for the linear program we wrote down, is this. And if I had more time, I would actually explain a little bit about where that comes from. But basically, you know, if you write down the saddle point problem for the problem of maximizing a variable, there's a corresponding problem. Part of the saddle point problem says you have to find the dual variables, the shadow prices. And the dual problem is the problem of finding the shadow prices. You have a price, you find shadow prices. In the primal problem, you've got a constraint that says each worker can match with no more than one firm, right? That constraint has a dual variable associated with it. We call it WL, right? Every firm has a constraint that says that each firm can only match with at most one worker. That constraint has a dual variable. We call that pi F, okay? So now what we do is we do the usual Lagrangian thing, and we find we find both the solution to the dual and the shadow prices, right? This is oftentimes what you've done when you solved any constrained maximization problem, right? You find the Lagrange multipliers, right? Well, the WLs and the pi Fs are Lagrange multipliers, okay? And this is the problem for finding the Lagrange multipliers. The theory of linear programming tells us the following thing. It says that the value of the dual, what is the value of the dual problem here? What is the dual problem says I want to find some wages, and I want to find some prices. I want to find profits, rather. I want to find shadow values for workers and firms. And I want to minimize those subject to the constraint, which is the natural stability constraint that says that pi f plus wl is at least as big as vlf for anybody, for any possible pair. Okay? And that problem has a solution. And the value of that solution is the same as the value of the primal problem. So what that says is that when you find your WLs and your pi Fs, the sum of all those payments is going to be equal to the value of the optimal match. In other words, we're dividing up all of the surplus. Okay. Furthermore, everybody, of course, is earning at least what they're getting in their match. Okay. And with a little bit of work from the linear programming formalism, a property called complementary slackness that some of you might have heard of, it's easy to see that if L and F are matched, this has to be true. That this has to be equality. So pi F plus WL equals VLF, they're splitting the surplus. Okay. On the other hand, for any other match, we have this inequality going on, which would mean that people wouldn't want to split. So now what does the dual linear program give us? It gives us a distribution of the rents from every single match in the optimal match, 1 minute until I shut up, okay. It gives us this distribution that makes the match stable, okay. So here's a nice theory of stable matches. We found a network. What is the network? It's a matching of workers and firms, okay. This network is stable in that there is a division of the surplus that each match is generating, right? Such that no one will want to break up and go with anybody else. Now, how do we generalize this? How do we generalize this to arbitrary networks? So this is the idea of Matt Jackson and Asher Walensky in a paper that was published in JET in the 1980s. And the idea is the following, okay? And there are different versions of this idea, but here's basically the idea. It says, let's assign a value to every graph. The value of a graph here is the sum of the surplus that it generates. Let's imagine that every individual has a utility that he or she assigns to every possible graph. And that probably depends upon what he or she, Scott, you should have been here earlier, you could have done all of this. This depends upon probably it depends upon this person's links, but the theory itself imposes no such constraints. So we have a value, right, for every graph. And now we want everybody to perform the following experiment, okay? We want the graph to have, and here's the stability concept. We want the graph to have the following property, that there is no missing edge, that if we add it, gives us a new graph which the two connected people like more. Okay? Second, there is no edge that any one person has that he or she wants to drop. Or in different versions of stability, any set of edges that he or she wants to drop. Or in yet another version of stability, that nobody wants to quit and say, I don't want to play this game at all, I want to go off on my own. Okay? So those are three possibilities for constraints in that direction. Okay? So that is, and any network which satisfies that we don't want to add an edge and we don't want to drop one edge or more edges or something like that, right? That's a stable network. Now, how does that help you econometrically? Well, it helps you econometrically because that gives you a bunch of inequalities. If you actually write down a utility function that for the network, that say, for example, the more links I have, the better off I am, and so on and so forth, right? Now you actually can estimate, you get inequalities that can, in fact, help you estimate these parameters. But of course, as you pointed out in this discussion that we had earlier, typically what you get out of these models are partial identification of utility parameters, okay? Because you might not have enough inequalities to pin everything down. Okay. Nonetheless, it is a way to proceed. Now, here's the problem with all of this. The problem with all of this is that stable networks don't always exist. Okay. If you give me an arbitrary utility function and you an arbitrary utility function, we all have arbitrary utility functions, no guarantee a stable network is going to exist. Furthermore, outside of special cases, we don't have a general theory that says, you know, for a large class of utility functions that look like so, we will have stable networks. Right? And so one thing I think one has to worry about is writing down an econometric specification that assumes there's always going to be a stable network, for example, for any draws of the error terms, right? When in fact there may not be, right? And how do you check that? That's a difficult thing to do. So I am not entirely convinced that stability helps us a great deal. And I'll make one more comment and then I will stop, Valerie. And that last comment is another problem that I have with stability is this idea that if there's an edge that's missing, that we both value, it should be there, right? We should add it, right? The problem I have with this is imagine in small social networks, this may be fine. In large social networks, how do I find you? How do I even know that that's the case, right? So this is a strong informational constraint. And if you're thinking about matching in large labor markets, this is probably inappropriate, right? In other contexts, it will be appropriate, but that, again, is context dependent, as is much of the application of all the theory that we've talked about this morning. And on that deep fact, I think we'll break for lunch. Thanks.